Oh, Chief Osceola has it electric in here. The crowd getting whipped into a frenzy as the Chief is getting set to throw the spear down and get Florida State and Florida ready underway. Stanford and Cal, the big game, they don't battle for a spear. They battle for an axe. And, well, it was Cal that pretty much chopped up the Cardinal, Marshawn Lynch. Not J.J. Arrington, but it was the freshman.
What a great job there, keeping his feet, keeping his balance, and the strength. How many missed tackles did Stanford have? The vision, get it back outside, pick up a couple blockers. What a terrific run right there, Reed.
And Marshawn Lynch not just doing it with his feet, but you know the Cal receiving corps starting to get healthier. And here is Lynch on a little trickeration, finding Burl Toler for the touchdown. 30 Golden Bears pull away 41-6. They still have to finish against Southern Mississippi. They will almost certainly be BCS eligible and almost certainly headed to the Rose Bowl to take on Michigan. We're getting ready for this one, Florida and Florida State. How do you see this one? Do the Gators have a chance to knock off the North?
Well, I think they have a chance, but I think this is about Florida State. It's about their defense, but I think it also comes down to Wyatt Sexton, the young Wyatt Sexton. Can he handle the atmosphere, this big game atmosphere right here, Mark, and the pressure that Florida's defense is going to bring after him?
I think for Florida, it's up to their quarterback, Chris Lee, coming off a 6-touchdown effort against South Carolina. Can he generate enough offense for Florida in this football game? I don't think he can. I think he'll be able to put up some big numbers, but it won't be enough to beat Florida State. I think Florida State will win this in the postseason.
You know, the Seminole offense has been very good here at Doak Campbell, very bad on the road. Doesn't matter because they're not on the road tonight. The crowd is behind them. Seminoles and Gators in a Sunshine State Classic getting set to get underway. And Ron Franklin's upstairs. He'll have the call for us. Ron?
The 8-2 Florida State Seminoles have enjoyed a successful season. The 6-4 Florida Gators, a disappointing one. But in this, the regular season finale for both teams, they are playing each other. And that's all that matters tonight. For a moment, forget the numbers, the standings, and the polls. And the headlines, who needs them when history is at hand? When on one Saturday night, a year of bragging rights is up for grabs. Far deeper than any fact or figure is this good old-fashioned feud. The recent past and the records are forgotten when these teams take the field for a game they'll always remember. Crowd here tonight at Doak Campbell Stadium and a dedication just moments ago. It is now Bobby Bowden Field at Doak Campbell Stadium. Coach Bowden and his wife Ann were honored down on the field, and right now the seniors being escorted along to the sideline along with their parents. It is quite an emotional evening here, as it is all over the country, when these youngsters say so long to the university after either 4 or 5 years of service on their football team. Welcome to ESPN's College Football. Tonight, the Florida Gators take on the number 8 Florida State Seminoles as Rivalry Week, presented by Pontiac, continues. ESPN Saturday Night College Football is broadcast in high definition, presented by Phillips and Best Buy. Hi, everybody. Ron Franklin along with Mike Gottfried, and welcome to Tallahassee, Florida. For the Seminoles tonight, the field has just been dedicated to their head coach of so many years. And also, the Seminoles play with this in mind. There is a situation where they can still be a BCS representative of the ACC, even though they lost in head-to-head competition to Miami at the very beginning of this year. And as the game goes on, we'll explain exactly how that could happen. Mike Gottfried, let's talk about Wyatt Sexton, the young quarterback who was taken over for Chris Ricks, and he has been a very able replacement, although only a sophomore.
The night we watched him against Virginia, he played very well, but he's going to go against a different defense tonight. Florida defense is going to come after him. They're going to blitz him, try to get him unnerved and early in this football game. His best weapons is Booker and Washington if he can get the running game going.
Right now, the Florida State Seminoles take the field, much to the delight of this partisan capacity house. And for many of these players, I mentioned the last time that they will take the field here wearing the garnet and gold. Well, Speaking of emotions and these seniors here, Mike, let's talk about the other side of the football. Ron Zook, it has been well documented, fired in the month of October, of all things, by a college program. And tonight, his kids, not just his seniors, but a lot of these kids who really are boosters of Ron Zook, it's an emotional night for them. They've got something to prove as well.
Ron, it really is. And what Florida State will face, a loose football team led by Chris Leak, the quarterback. Now, Chris Leak's got to have a good night in the throwing game because the running defense of Florida State is very solid. So he's going to have to throw the ball and throw it deep.
So let's take a timeout. We'll be back with the opening kickoff as Florida State plays host to the Florida Gators.
ESPN's College Football Saturday Primetime, brought to you by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And Zales, the diamond store. Pontiac presents ESPN's College Football Rivalry Weekend.
Welcome back to Doak Campbell Stadium. Quickly, let's go down to the sideline. The third member of our broadcast team, Aaron Andrews, is with head coach Ron Zook. Aaron.
Ron, thank you. Coach, it's been 18 years since the Gators last won here. Even Steve Spurrier was unable to win in Tallahassee. With everything that you've been through in the last couple of weeks, what would a victory mean to you, your players, and your coaching staff?
Well, you know, I love it for the players, the coaches, and all the true Gator fans. I mean, that's, you know, we're going to do our best. So we're going to give it. These guys are going to play hard, I promise you.
What did you tell them as you walked out tonight, coach?
Let's go play hard and have fun.
Thank you. Ron, back to you.
Okay, Aaron, thanks very much. Great hustle there. I know Ron just literally moments away from the opening kickoff. In the toss of the coin here this evening, it is going to be, let's see, Florida State has won. They have deferred. So it will be the Florida Gators who will go on offense first tonight. And from what head coach Bobby Bowden told us yesterday, as you look at his numbers, 350 career wins in his 29th season, he wants to put that defense out there first. And he said there were a couple of games earlier this year that probably he should have done that when his offense actually wound up going on the field first. Here is the series history. 27-19-2, Florida leads it all time. The last win, Tallahassee, 1986 by 4. Florida State won 5 of the last 6, 7-0-1 in the last 8 home meetings. So the numbers are in their favor, but this is a totally different situation.
Ron, don't forget Florida State's problems in the kicking game. Clemson returned 2 kickoffs against them for touchdowns.
So Beatty will kick it off. And you take a look at McCollum, number 18, Tremaine, one of the deep backs, lined up at the goal line. And Jamal Cornelius, a sophomore out of Fort Meade, back there with him in the dual safety position. Florida State underway for 2004. He will not return it. 6 yards deep in the end zone, and it gives us an opportunity to talk about the starting quarterback, the sophomore out of Charlotte, North Carolina, Chris Leak. He has had good ball games. He's had a couple that were off, but in this one tonight, Mike, he's going to have, got to have his A game.
He's got to play at the highest ability. Now, Ron, when you look at Chris Leak, he's only a sophomore. He's been playing at Florida since his freshman year. Experienced, but still just a young guy in this program.
Well, he's trying to get loose, but he's also, he's pretty hyper right now. Shatrick facing the tailback and able to split out and go empty in the backfield. Here comes pressure up front. Pass over the middle, got it complete at the 24-yard line. It'll be good for 4 to Caldwell, and it gives us an opportunity to complete the remainder of the starters. Faison, Tate Casey, only a freshman. Now the starter at tight end. 3 wide receivers, Baker, O.J. Small, and Andre Caldwell out of Tampa, who just made that reception. Up front, Colin in hand at the tackles. Butler, huge Mo Mitchell, 6'7", 370 at right guard, and DeGore is the center. Gavin Dickey at quarterback, number 17, and he's out of right here in Tallahassee. Big opening, and he cut it to the outside instead of saving in the middle. He had an absolute ton to run through. The defenders who start for the Seminoles, and here's the way they go. The down 4, Chauncey Davis, Travis Johnson, the best of the upfront group, Clifton Dixon, and Eric Moore. The linebackers, very quick, and their bruisers, Sims, Buster Davis, A.J. Nicholson. In the secondary, McFadden and Smith at the corners, Watkins and Jerome Carter are the safeties. Chris Leak is back at a quarterback on third down. Throws it out in the flat. Hit immediately and knocked down for about a four-yard loss as Pat Watkins comes from nowhere to make the tackle, and it's going to be a three-and-out situation for Florida.
You want to set the tempo early in the football game. Pat Watkins sets the tempo for the Florida State defense with the tackle of Faison.
Well, I'll tell you what, Faison is lucky he didn't lose the football because he had just received it. Eric Wilbur, the sophomore out of Winter Park, prepares to punt it away to Willie Reed. What a start to the game. And this is a line drive, very returnable from his own 35, 40, 45, 50. Breaks away, got one man to beat, and he is tackled by the kicker at the 35-yard line. Wilbur was the safety valve, and he made the stop as a flag is down. And it's back at the line of scrimmage.
Maybe a bad formation by Florida.
Steve Shaw, our referee tonight, and here comes the call. It is against the Gators. And Mike, it could be that situation of not enough men on the line of scrimmage.
And it's a tough start for Florida.
Illegal formation on the offense. The right tackle was off the line of scrimmage. Penalty is declined. First and 10.
That's what you don't want to give Wyatt Sexton early, a good field position to get off to a good start.
Well, they did just that as that return. And if it were not for Wilbur, the Seminoles would be on the board 6-0 right now. But they scrimmage from the Gators' 35-yard line. Outstanding field position to open the ball game. Play action. Saxton gets a good block right over the middle. Ball is tipped and then almost intercepted. It hit Chauncey Stovall where? Right in the hands. Whoa.
Ron, you're right. It hit him right in the hands on a crossing route. Good protection. This ball is delivered right where you want it at. Chauncey Stovall couldn't hold on. Took his eyes off the football.
Well, he was trying to nurture the thing in there, but he let it come too far as you take a look at Sexton. Out of right here in Tallahassee, his dad, Billy, is the Florida State assistant head coach. There's a good look at him. Florida shows blitz off the corner. Here they come from the top of your screen. Pass, ball is tipped. Wow, that was almost intercepted. And that would have been, Seiler would have been headed to the end zone if he picks that one off right there.
Do you talk about the young player? Seiler's a freshman.
So the remainder of the starters, Leon Washington and James Coleman in the backfield. Paul Irons, the tight end. Chauncey Stovall and Crapanzo Thorpe are the wide receivers up front. No two better tackles in the land than Willis and Barron. Niblock, along with Bobby Meeks at the guards. David Castillo has a broken finger, and the thing keeps popping out. He said, doesn't matter, I'm going to play. And Bobby Bowden said, he's just a tough guy. We expect him to be there.
Good screen down here.
Going to throw for the end zone. Got a fade going, had the man open, and he overthrows Chauncey Stovall. And now as we look, Brian Ross has come into the ballgame at center rather than David Castillo, and we'll keep an eye on Castillo and see what he does get back. Here's the pass, and boy, he had it.
Good job by Webb forcing him inside, though, and you ran out of room. Good series by Florida. Now here's where, again, where you got to look at the fake possibilities if you're Florida on defense.
Chris Hall comes on to punt, the junior out of Centerville, Virginia. Vernell Brown is the deep man. Florida State, great opportunity and could not do anything with it. Here's the pooch kick, and it's going to hit at the one-yard line and knocked out of bounds. That's going to be Pat Watkins, who had that jarring tackle to end the first offensive series for the Gators. 33 in the punt, but boy, it is on the spot. Take a timeout. We'll be right back. Part of the capacity house here tonight. Let's go down to the sideline quickly and check in with Aaron Andrews. Aaron, what do you have for us?
Well, Ron, because of all the unnecessary fighting last night in that NBA game in Detroit and also the college football game at Clemson today, you better believe there were some things done for this game today. During the pregame warmups, head coach Bobby Bowden stood on Florida State's logo to kind of deter both teams from gathering in the center and fighting, which in the past they have done before the game. Also, some of the officials told me they brought in more officials during that pregame warmup just in case anything happened. Guys?
Okay, well, it has been well patrolled, and so far as it has been well behaved as we had the man in motion cut toward the line of scrimmage.
Two guys in motion, yeah. Ron, so they'll, I would think Florida State will take the play here, not the penalty.
Illegal shift. The fullback and the wideout was moving together and neither got set. The penalty is declined. Second down.
Okay, so Steve Shaw with the explanation, just exactly what you were talking about. And you could see big Travis Johnson, number 99, come in and say, nope, we'll take the play.
So it'll be you're only talking about 2 yards, so give up a down.
What a special teams play that has backed up the Gators to their own 3 yard line. Chad Jackson in motion. They try to go with the running play, and I mean, there's just nothing there. Clifton Dixon steps up into the pile to make the hit. The ball came loose, but it obviously was after the play had been whistled dead. And now it's going to be third down and very long for the Gators. And Mike, let's take a look at the game plans, first of all, for the Florida Gators.
Yeah, get Chris Leak in the early rhythm. They haven't done it yet. This is going to be a big third down. Face on in the running game, his versatility, get him the ball. Load up to stop the run on defense and pressure Sexton. They came after him the first 3 plays of this football game.
So here comes third down, and Leak standing in his own end zone. Well, they've gone empty again in the backfield. Let's see if this is an automatic blitz. Nope. Florida State will only send 4. There's the pass. Got it complete. That's enough for the first down to O.J. Small. And what a pass by Leak, throwing across his body. And he waited a long time and hit him for a 16-yard strike.
Chris Leak, they rolled him to the left. Here at the goal line situation, they seal everything inside. And Chris Leak, against his body, finds O.J. Small, a big first down.
Well, everybody talks about it, and we all know that is a difficult throw, but he was absolutely perfect with it. And the most important thing, if you're a Florida fan, keeps the drive alive. Pitchback facing, tries to turn it back into the short side of the field. He's going to have 5, maybe 6 yards on the play. Defensively, Leroy Smith, the senior out of Quincy, Florida, comes over from that right cornerback position to make the stop.
Such a tough team, Florida State, to run against. Only giving up 61 yards per game per rush, only 3 rushing touchdowns. No one has run the football against them this year.
But only 3 there, as you see them showing blitz. Let's see if they do come. No, it looks as though they'll come off of it now. They've only given up 6 passing touchdowns, so 9 in 10 ball games, which is extremely impressive. Plenty of time on the play clock at 6. Here comes the blitz off the corner. Going to have to hurry and gets this one away. Now a comeback. Got it complete to number 5, Andre Caldwell. And he is going to have still another first down. Reese Davis, let's check in with you following that 13-yard gain.
All right, Ron, Taco Bell takes us out to Salt Lake City. Utah and BYU tied at 7. Game going on over on ESPN2. Marty Johnson will go in for the 14th time this season. It's a Utah single-season record. And the Utes hoping to sew up a spot in the BCS up a touch.
Our situation, no score. Pass goes to Caldwell, close to the first down. He's going to be tackled about 1.5 yards short. But he will move the football out in the vicinity of the 45-yard line.
Good drive when you get the ball out of your own end zone. The other thing Florida is doing to FSU is the tempo of the football game, the no huddle, trying to speed their play up.
Florida State bouncing around on defense again, back into the short side of the field. Skyler Thornton with the run, and from where they have put a foot down, I believe Mikey's going to have the first down. Roger Williams coming over to make the stop out of the secondary.
What that tempo does, Ron, is you don't get to huddle. You don't get to look in your eyes of your own defensive guys. Substitutions become a problem. Florida just taking it to Florida State with the tempo of this football game.
Mickey Andrews told us yesterday in the meeting that they'll rotate as many as 12 defensive linemen. Hard to rotate, though, when the offense is going quickly. Back to throw. Wanted to throw the screen pass. Flag is down. Dumps it off to the tight end. And Tate Casey loses the football. Florida State has it at the 48-yard line. Now let's check all the markers. Buster Davis has the football. So the officials have
offsides on number six on the defense. That'll be 5 yards from the previous spot. And repeat first down.
Willie Jones is the man who came across too quickly. Talk about a big play.
And Florida State has been a heavily penalized football team this year. Another mistake by FSU in the penalty department.
Now, Willie Jones, actually, one of those 12 that rotate. He's not a starter, but that's a play that could loom very big in this ball game, because now it's the eighth play of the drive. It started at the 3, and the Seminoles don't have the football. Running play with Faison close to the first down as he goes inside the 45 to around the 42-yard line.
Here's what we were talking about, Ron, for the season. 77 yards in penalties. That goes a long way in setting back your offense and defense. Another penalty flag down. Maybe a face mask or a late hit.
Well, first of all, Steve Shaw is going to call for the change to come in, I believe.
Dead ball, personal foul on the offense. We will measure and then give the results of the play.
So what happens here, they're going to measure it here. If he does have the first down.
Yeah, Mo Mitchell right here, number 61, should have been thrown out of the football game.
Elbow to the back of the head. That one was pretty obvious as he was working on Sam McGrew there. Mo, 6'7", 370 pounds. Now what will happen? It'll be first down as they got the measurement, and then the penalty, because it was post play, will be stepped off. And you see Ron Zook saying no excuse for that.
Then dead ball, personal foul, 61 on the offense. That'll be 15-yard penalty, and it will be first and 10.
They can't make those kind of mistakes on offense. A young football team, but that's a senior, Mo Mitchell, with that air.
Steve Whistler, number 79, a sophomore out of Sarasota Riverview, 6'3", 300 pounds, comes in replacing Mitchell at that guard position. Skyler Thornton into the ballgame at tailback, number 25.
They have what they want up here if they want to fade.
Thornton gets the ball. The running play is not going to go for anything. In fact, he's going to lose a yard. And boy, look at that gang tackling 44. Sam McGrew, one of the men on the top of the pile. And down at the bottom was Clifton Dixon, number 97, a sophomore out of Miami, Florida. Started back in that Virginia ball game. They have had a lot of injuries. And as far as FSU is concerned, it's a good thing they rotate so many people on that defensive front, Mike.
They've always done that. Mickey Andrews always plays a lot of young guys early in the football season.
Second down, about 10 and a half yards for the first down. Leak, play action. Here's pressure. Has to hurry on this one. Has it incomplete to Markell Thompson. Boy, and he was just running for his life as the Seminoles were bringing forth a lot of pressure on that play.
And Mickey Andrews, a very good defensive coordinator. Kevin Steele, the linebackers coach, is outstanding also. They feel they have a good plan. They played great defense all year.
You know, most of the times, Mike, they rarely bring a linebacker. They stay at home with it. They might bring a safety, but they get the pressure with those down four. 11th play of the drive on third down. Got to go all the way to the 47 at the other end of the field. Got a man out there. Blown coverage. It is caught at the 21-yard line by Chad Jackson.
I was watching Chris Leak. I think he was surprised, shocked that Jackson came open. He looks for the football. He looks to throw the football. I don't think Pat Watkins got over the top fast enough. And the ball had to be waited on by Chad Jackson. If he airs it out, he's got to score.
37 yards in the pass play. It is first and 10 for the Gators, who started at their own 3-yard line. You see the ball resting. They've spotted it at the FSU 20. No score. Gators driving. Faison is the tailback, and he's got Latsko in front of him at fullback. Over the middle, got a man, and it is knocked away. No flag, no interference. McFadden on the cover. Caldwell, the intended receiver.
Thrown well by Chris Leak. Andre Caldwell on a post route. I'm surprised again that Chris Leak is such a poised young quarterback, being a sophomore. Very close to interference on that last
play. Yeah, the right hand, you're exactly right. The right hand around the waist. Could have gotten him in trouble. Second down. Shovel pass right up the middle. Faison running hard. Going to have a gain of close to 7 on the play. Jerome Carter is the man who is there to make the hit. Carter, an outstanding story. He's one of many seniors in this ballgame tonight out of Lake City, Florida. A captain of the defense. He started off his freshman year with a block of a punt against Duke. He scored a touchdown. And Mickey Andrews said, from there on, we knew we had ourselves a good football player. Fade to the opposite ball side. Touchdown, Florida. Chad Jackson, 13 yards.
The pace of this football game is what Florida is using to be successful against this defense. Excellent pace by the Florida coaches.
Matt Leach, the sophomore out of Sarasota, comes into the ball game to try to make it 7-0. Good pass, and he knocks it home, and will take a timeout. 7:56 left until halftime, and as we go to break, one more look at this 13-yard touchdown strike to Jackson in the corner of the end zone. There it is right there, 7-0. The Florida Gators go on top in this rivalry weekend game. So welcome back. How many times do you see the big rivalry games, and all of a sudden the team that is the decided underdog in a contest goes on the board first? And Florida's the type of football team, but the talent they have, Florida State's got to do a good job of not allowing them to hang around.
No, when you look at that graphic, that tells it all about this defense. Mickey Andrews' defense now giving up 7 touchdown passes. But I like what Chris Leak did and the play calls and the fast pace in this game for Florida.
Well, it was the right combination, and right now it has Florida State kind of second-guessing themselves a little bit as Petrovich kicks it off. This is returnable very high at the 3-yard line. And it's Cromartie, near side, turns the corner, 20, 30. Caught from behind at the 36-yard line, and there's a marker down at the 17-yard line. Aaron Andrews, let's check with you.
Well, Ron, Florida State quarterback Wyatt Sexton getting ready to take the field for the Noles offense. And, of course, he's wearing garnet and gold tonight, but that wasn't the case last Saturday. He attended the Florida Gators' last home game last weekend. He went up to visit some friends. Like I said, they went to the game. It got cold at that game, so he decided to put on a Gator sweatshirt. We heard that was all that was the only sweatshirt available, so that's what he put on. I asked head coach Bobby Bowden about it. He said, "That's just Wyatt for you." Travis Johnson, his defensive teammate, said he knows what jersey to wear tonight, guys.
Okay. Well, if he knew he was going to cause such a stir, he should have turned it inside out.
Ron, the most important thing for him is not his jersey right now, but he's backed up in bad field position. All of a sudden, the pressure is on the offense of Florida State.
Well, a change as far as the tailback is concerned. Washington on the sideline. And now the slasher, Lorenzo Booker, number 28, comes in a tailback. But it's a quick out pass near sideline to Stovall, and Chauncey is going to be knocked out of bounds at the 12. Reese Davis, let's check back with you. What do you got for us?
All right, Ron Seiko says it's time to check in on the Civil War. Oregon and Oregon State. Beavers up 13-7. And Derek Anderson finds Marcel Love. Squeezes it into the end zone, and Beavers on top of the Ducks, 20-7, late in the first.
I'll tell you, that Oregon State team has had some difficult times this year. That would put Sav in a lot of wounds, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Back to throw, quick pass, maybe a little too swift to Lorenzo Booker. That is three drop passes, though, that Florida State has in the early going. Lack of focus.
And you can see the frustration on the face of Wyatt Sexton because he knows he's got a big play here on the angle pass to Lorenzo Booker if he makes the first down. There's a slow start you're talking about the first quarter. And then the second to fourth, they get going a little bit.
That's when they put it in overdrive. Third down, they need to take it out to the 19-yard line if they want to keep this drive going. Gators on top, 7-0. Sexton, here comes a blitz. They throw the screen short side of the field to Coleman. And Coleman is not going to have the first down. He'll miss it by, about a half a yard, it would appear. And, Mike, you're not in gambling range right here, are you?
No, not with this offense. You've got to punt the football. They're going to check a measurement. Jarvis Herring, Demetrius Webb in on the tackle. You talked about lack of focus. I think both teams are a little nervous. Florida loose as a goose because they have nothing to lose or win here except this football game. Their coach is out and just a matter of where they go to the bowl game. Florida State still in the hunt for the BCS.
Yeah, you know, you have to wonder also, besides the fact that these teams are so high for each other, but yet both coaching staffs have really put their foot down on behavior in this ball game tonight because of the idiotic thing that happened last night in the NBA and the fisticuffs that went on today up at Clemson. And both coaches have just simply laid the law down and said that will not occur at this stadium tonight. Do you understand? So you wonder if that took a little edge off of them, right? Chris Hall comes in to punt. Second time that they have punted in this ball game this evening. Vernell Brown is the deep man. Here's the kick. Line drive. Very good kick. And a great job by the Gunners. Gets by the first. Will not get by the second. And the tackle made at the 36-yard line by Pat Watkins. He has been everywhere. 49 yards in the boot. Let's take a timeout. Well, the aerial coverage for tonight's game, courtesy of Outback Steakhouse Airship, Bloomin' Onion 1. The Outback Steakhouse Airship specializes in college football and PGA golf events. Look for the Bloomin' Onion 1 at a sporting event throughout the year. Well, that Florida drive, the last time they had the football, quite impressive. 14 plays, 97 yards, using up 4 minutes and 46 seconds. Gavin Dickey in the ballgame at tailback, number 17.
He's the running quarterback.
But they do the option. Faison gets the handoff, and he will have a gain of 3. Aaron Andrews, let's check back with you.
Well, Ron, ever since Florida head coach Ron Zook was fired in October, his motto has been ride on. In fact, he had it printed up on these T-shirts right before the Georgia game. He passed it out to his players. They are wearing this under their pads. On the back of it, it says coaches, team, and family. That's what they are playing for. In fact, Ron Zook is even wearing one under his shirt, guys.
Okay, Aaron, it's a second down. Here comes blitz from all over the place, running play, and not much there. He will not make the 40-yard line as Jerome Carter comes up to make the tackle. And now it's going to be a third down for the Gators, and they need to take it to the 46-and-a-half-yard line if they want to keep this one going.
Here's the blitz right here. Both linebackers coming in. You see the blocking in the Florida State defensive line handling the line of scrimmage. Travis Johnson's a load to block.
Third down, Florida. Empty in the backfield. Here comes the blitz right up the middle. Gets his pass away. Complete, but short of the first down by about 3 yards to O.J. Small, the senior out of Jacksonville. The most consistent of those Gator wide receivers, but they'll have to bring on the punting unit. And a nice job of the defense, particularly Eric Moore with pressure on Leak on that play.
Yeah, I was going to say they had pressure on Chris Leak. He couldn't take time enough to get the ball downfield.
Eric Wilbur had a really good kick his first time, but he also had to be safety valve and make the touchdown saving tackle. Much better here. Very high, good coverage kick, and very long. Fair catch called and made at the 11-yard line. Reese Davis, what do you have for us following that 46-yard punt?
Right, Ron Miller taking us out to Salt Lake City. Utah and BYU, the Utes are on the move inside the 25 when Alex Smith is picked off by Nate Solberg. A lot of room and opportunity, but the Heisman candidate able to save the touchdown, but only momentarily. The Cougars go to Curtis Brown. Curtis Brown is into the end zone, and the Cougars have it tied up 14-14 on ESPN2, getting close to halftime.
Our situation, 7-0. Florida on top. We've got 5:16 to play in this opening quarter. Straight ahead with the running play. There's not much there, as both of these running defenses are outstanding. Mike, what about Florida State, their game plan?
Ron, they got to run the football. They got to take pressure off of Wyatt Sexton. 30-plus carries by both tailbacks. Protect the football. No turnovers by Sexton. Pressure leak with the front four. They've got some pressure on him, not enough. Four straight turnovers or more on defense to get the field position. Battle changed.
Wyatt Sexton looks at a second down and long. Leon Washington against the tailback standing alongside him. And that's who they'll give it to as the flag goes down. And he's not going to have anything. In fact, maybe back to the line of scrimmage or even loss of a half yard. And now let's see what that marker is about as Jarvis Herring was there to make the defensive play. Like the defense might have been offside.
Offside, number 93 on the defense, 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
Stephen Harris, and he's a second teamer, sophomore out of Miami, Coral Gables. Got him away from the Miami Hurricanes, offside in the play, so they'll get to do second down over again. And a little bit different call here with the second down and short.
Yeah, I was getting ready to say, Ron, that you got to put Wyatt Sexton, if you're Florida, in third and long yardage situation. Beg for the turnover. You can get the turnover on Sexton.
Chris Ricks on the sideline, who has been the starter, went down with an ankle injury, has not been able to wrestle his job back away from Sexton. Wyatt steps up into the pocket, drills the ball, has it complete. Number 15 again, Chauncey Stovall, the senior out of Vero Beach. And that is a huge first down on a gain of 21 yards. Stovall gives you that big receiver opportunity, 6'2", and he leaps so well, Mike.
And the protection, Ron, was excellent. They gave Wyatt Sexton time. He slid up in the pocket, found the receiver open. Stovall completed pass. Excellent protection.
Well, those fullbacks never get any credit, so let me mention James Coleman, the junior out of right here in Tallahassee, number 36, the fullback who had an outstanding block to help out his quarterback. They'll give it to the tailback. Here comes Washington. Hit behind the line of scrimmage. That's Joe Cohen, and the sophomore is right there to mess that play up. And all of a sudden, instead of playing in front of the chains, now the Florida defense making the Seminoles play behind the chains.
You're right, Ron. Cologne with a good play here, beating the block of the offensive tackle in the backfield.
Boy, they got great penetration on that play. And even as outstanding a back as Leon Washington is, doesn't matter. There's no way you can get around the grips of the likes of those kind of guys. Cohen, a sophomore out of Melbourne, Florida. Second down and 14. Steps to throw right over the middle. Ooh, threw it way behind him, and he had him open. Was just underneath Dominic Robinson, the intended receiver. Dominic is out of Diamond Bar, California. Actually, SC and UCLA were after him. He's not too far from there, as you look at Wyatt Sexton and his number.
Yeah, at home, he's a different quarterback. 6 touchdowns, 1 interception. On the road, 2 TDs, 6 INTs.
Well, he's got a third down here. And if they want to keep this drive going from this location, they have to take it out to midfield. Exactly, the 50-yard line for the first. Sexton steps up into the pocket, going to run. Gets by one tackler, will not get by the third and fourth. And again, Joe Cohen with a shot at him. It'll be short of the first down.
If you told Florida that Wyatt Sexton was going to run, they'd let him run. He's not a running threat at quarterback. Not somebody who's going to hurt you.
So it's punting time again for the Seminoles as they look at a fourth down and six, third punt of this opening quarter. And we're at the 2 minute and 30 second mark. They got a return on this is a line drive punt. He's going to let this one go and it'll go into the end zone. They'll get it at the 20. Well, Monday night at ESPN2 at 7 p.m. coverage of college basketball's Feast Week continues as J.J. Redick and the 12th-ranked Duke Blue Devils take on the Davidson Wildcats. Then at 9, the BYU Cougars face off against Rashad McCants and the number 3 North Carolina Tar Heels in the EA Sports Maui Invitational. And, of course, the Tar Heels stinging from that opening game loss to Santa Clara. Skyler Thornton, number 25, comes into the ball game at tailback for Florida. Play action. Leak. Gonna run it and then just step out of bounds, and he slipped. And now you see the Florida State player, Clifton Dixon, who was right there helping him up, because actually his feet went out from under him, and the Florida faithful thought maybe a flag should have been thrown, but I don't think there was any malice or forethought here as far as the way the play wound up.
No, the one thing you also that you got to keep in mind is he just slipped. As you look at this football game, Florida State's defensive line having to chase Chris Leak. It's a good thing they do play a lot of defensive linemen.
That's the truth. Well, Clifton Dixon, though, for 6'4", 285, you could see he was running pretty doggone well. Second down and 14. Shovel pass right up the middle. Thornton, 20, out to the 25. And that play right there is going to put him back in a position that is makes it reasonable to pick up the first down as McGrew was on the stop.
What that play says is go ahead and rush our quarterback. We're going to run this shovel draw just enough to slow your rush down.
Sam McGrew on the tackle, the junior out of Crawfordville. Here's third down, and very quickly they get it off, and the pass is caught by Caldwell. And Mike, again, the quick play, the quick tempo of the ball game as Florida State has a player down, and the Seminoles are having a little trouble each drive adapting to that.
Ron, you're exactly right. The pace of this football game, the tempo of Florida's offense is really posing a problem for FSU's defense.
Well, while we check on the injury, let's check in with Reese Davis. Reese?
All right, Ryan, and we'll check in again on Utah and BYU after Alex Smith threw that interception to set up the BYU touchdown. That's a little busted play, but Utah's offense is so good that Alex Smith just scored his 10th touchdown of the year on it. The Utes are back on top late in the first half by seven.
Okay, Reese, the injured player, Travis Johnson, talked with him yesterday. His parents had come in, and in fact caught him on his cell phone, and I asked him, I said, I know this is a huge night as far as emotion being a senior, and he said, yeah, but the biggest thing is, he said, my mama came a long way to see me play in person, and I've got a lot of showing to do. So he wants to make sure that he does put on a good show, and she certainly doesn't want to see him in a prone position on the field.
He's a first round pick. He talked about senior night. His heart, his teammates, loves Florida State.
First down, here's the pitch, goes back to Thornton, turns the corner, has 5, has 10, and he's off and running. Let's count it off at about 15 yards in the carry as Florida comes up again with a running play, and it is difficult to outrun a play that is wide, that defense, but they do here.
This is about as well called a first quarter by the offensive coaches of Florida as I've seen all year. Tempo, the play selection, excellent.
About to go into 1 minute left in the opening quarter. Leak going to go long over the middle, almost bit off more than he could chew as that ball could have been intercepted. Caldwell was the closest man to it.
Just think of this, Ron. They stretch in the width of the field with the option, the short passing game. They're throwing the length of the football field, the deep pass. They're putting a lot of pressure on this Seminole defense. 143 yards in the first quarter against a defense that's been solid all year.
Happy to report that number 99, Travis Johnson, back into the ball game at defensive tackle for the Seminoles. draw play right up the middle. Not much on this one, but again, they just keep chipping away and giving them different looks. Outside, inside, shovel draw, then the long pass. And as Mike said, it makes you think, and you got to stay on your toes. A.J. Nicholson made the stop on that play.
You've seen everything out of Florida in the first quarter. The play selection, inside runs, outside runs, the option play, misdirection. Good play action passing game.
That's Nicholson who came off the field as they bring him to the sideline for an extra defensive back. From the shotgun, third down, they need the 41. Got the draw play, and what a really fine defensive effort against Thornton as Leroy Smith. And I'm not so sure if he doesn't make that tackle, he might have had a lot of running room down the sideline.
Yeah, they had a double screen on to the left side. He fakes it to the left side, hits Thornton on the right side. Leroy Smith in good shape. First quarter's over.
It looks as though Leroy Smith's shaken up a little bit on that play. That's the end of the opening quarter, so let's take a timeout. It has been all Gators in the opening 15 minutes, 145 total yards. They lead it 7-0. So we are back. Not really a hot night, but a muggy night here in Tallahassee. And you can see the players really going after the water on the sideline. There's Leak on the far sideline. Boy, and at the first quarter of play, almost had the ball 11 of the 15 minutes that were played. Here's Wilbur with the punt. Very high, not going to turn over. Good coverage kick. No fair catch is called for at the 20-yard line. Willie Reed on the return. Tonight's game track brought to you by Pioneer. Well, a costly penalty because watch what happened. The tight end, Tate Casey, makes the reception, loses the football. It is picked up by Florida State. But offsides in the play, Florida State maintained possession, or Florida did, I should say. And then the touchdown pass right there. And that's how we stand, 7-0, as Chad Jackson recorded the six-pointer. So Florida State back on offense. They have the ball at their own 20. Just throws that one into the ground. Aaron Andrews, let's check with you on the sideline.
Well, Ron, word from Florida State's sideline. Senior quarterback, cornerback Leroy Smith left the game. He's going to get his right forearm x-rayed. When we get details, we'll let you know, but that's not good news, especially yesterday FSU's defensive coordinator Mickey Andrews saying this defense is extremely banged up. Ron?
Well, they have been. It's one of those things at this time of year. Most every ball club, though, has got a lot of nicks, a lot of injuries. But obviously a broken bone, if that is in fact the case, is something that's going to take him out of play, which they can ill afford. Second down and 10. Again for the shotgun. Sexton wields it out here, has a complete 25. And he'll take it up to around the 30-yard line before he's pushed out of bounds. Willie Reed, the junior out of Kathleen, Georgia, is the man on the receiving end. Little safety valve, and they're going to now have a third down situation and short, about a yard and a half.
When you look at Florida State, 3 rushing attempts, 6 yards. They can't win this football game unless they run the football and take the pressure off Sexton. Got to find a way to run the ball.
Well, the key stats tonight, time of possession, as we told you, almost 11 minutes in that opening quarter at 146 total yards to 37 for the Seminoles.
Now, unless you help them.
Ray McDonald jumped across. And when you're 6'3", 285, hard to hide.
Offsides, number 95 on the defense. 5-yard first and 10.
What Ray should have done is point. Just point to somebody that they drew you offside. Not like that. Just don't turn around. Start running in the secondary. You're guilty.
That's only the second first down of the first half by Florida State. So one by offense, one by penalty. Blitz coming off the corner to the short side of the field. Pass is thrown. Did he catch it? Nope. Out of bounds. That was Kerhonzo Thorpe, a senior out of right here in Tallahassee, played at Lincoln High School.
That ball was thrown so late, it could have been picked off also.
When you're throwing all the way across the field, obviously it is dangerous. But Mike, as you make the point, you throw that one late, and then you may have more than you can say grace over. 7-0, Florida leads it. 14-32 left in his opening half. Here comes a blitz. Linebackers, both of them right up the middle, and they hit him just as the ball gets there, and it's going to be caught by Chauncey Stovall. Stovall has been the go-to guy when they need a big play tonight. That's a gain of 12, and it's a first down.
Blocked very well by FSU's offensive line and Leon Washington. Sexton did get hit at the end of the play, but he had enough time to throw the football.
Brian Ross, the backup center, with an outstanding job of blocking on the play, number 71. B.J. Dean into the ball game at fullback. Sexton going to go on top. Got single coverage, and Stovall, the intended receiver, he walked all the way around the defensive back, who is Demetrius Webb.
Tried to air one out. Tried to get an easy throw here off the play action. Wyatt Sexton, but Florida covered the wide receiver very well.
Lorne Sam, sophomore out of Buford, Georgia, number 10. Comes back into the lineup. Brother of P.K. Sam, who played earlier here at Florida State. 6 seconds on the play clock. And he's just going to go down. Rather than having the ball knocked loose, Ray McDonald, who jumped off sides just a moment ago, one of the first men there, along with Earl Everett from the linebacking position.
We talked about the Virginia game because Virginia really had a good plan but didn't pressure Wyatt Sexton. Everybody after that game has really come after the quarterback because they feel he can't hurt him as a running threat.
We'll take a look at this graphic right here. Third down comparisons.
Third down, they've been anemic at 23.6.
They are 0 of 3 tonight. They need to take it all the way across midfield to the 43-yard line. Sexton steps up, heavy pressure on him, going to try to run, and a flag comes in late. He's going to go down at the 50. If that's holding, if I'm Florida, even though I'm going to get the football back, I might take it, Mike, because that's going to push it back to around the 25-yard line.
I agree with you. I look at the Florida coaches, and it looked like they were going to turn it down. I think I'd take it.
Because of field position.
Field position, yep. Move them back a little bit further.
Because you are talking about 25 yards difference here. The 50.
Holding, number 77 on the offense. Penalty is declined. Fourth down.
They're going to play the field position game and say we're not going to give Wyatt Sexton a chance to throw the deep throw to one wide receivers. Ray Willis. I believe it's on him, the right tackle.
So it's punting time by Chris Hall. The fourth time that Florida State has punted in his first half. And here's the boot. High driving spiral. Deep back will run away from it. It'll go all the way into the end zone. That is a long kick. 50 yards on the boot. They'll scrimmage from their own 20-yard line. 7-0, Florida on top. Well, you're looking at B.J. Dean, and the reason you are, there was a post-play foul. Here it is. Watch number 35 as he comes down the field, and this unsuspecting Florida player puts an elbow in the back, and the official said, we're not going to let anything be a catalyst to what happened earlier today in Clemson. They penalize the Florida State Seminoles 15 yards, so it's first down at the 35-yard line. Running play straight ahead with Faison ahead of steam, almost 10 yards on the play. It's going to be about 9.5. So 7-0, Mike Gottfried, as we join the audience here from the booth. And you have to say, Florida right now, if they can maintain the pace that they are offensively in this ball game, I tell you, Florida State's going to have to get up and play some better.
They really are. They're putting pressure on Florida State's offense. But if you're Ron Zook right now, you dominated the first quarter. You need more than 7 points because you've dominated time of possession, rushing game, passing game, but you're still only ahead 7 points.
Let me ask you this, though. What can Mickey Andrews and the defense, or head coach Bobby Bowden, what can they do to amend this situation?
They got to keep their offense on the field. That will help their defense.
See a stack at the top of the screen with the first down and 10, and they pump over there trying to decoy. They got single coverage, and the man was not open, and now it's just going to throw it away. Now, the Florida State coaches are all the way down the sideline saying they want intentional grounding. By rule, he is more than 5 yards outside the box or the tackle box, whichever you want to say, and by rule, the pass was beyond the line of scrimmage. There is no grounding.
Pretty good play by Chris Leko, because he slides, trying to find a window to throw the football, throws it away, doesn't make a mistake, try to force the ball.
Second down. They need to take the ball down to the 44-yard line. Again, Seatric Faison is the tailback. Cornelius in motion. Leak, good protection, got it complete to the tight end, Tate Casey. And he is a huge target. You ought to hear the coaches talk about this youngster. Only a freshman, 6'7", 230 pounds, and they really like his upside.
And, Ron, you talk about a freshman, Tate Casey. This is a team, a sophomore quarterback, receiver Tate Casey, a lot of young guys. They're going to be a top five team next year at the start of the season.
Whoever gets this football team, the coverage will be anything but bare.
It's full.
So Faison did not cut it back inside, is strung out, then knocked down for a loss. And Aaron Andrews has checked with you. What do you have?
Well, Ron, unfortunately, the news not good coming from Florida State's training room. Senior cornerback Leroy Smith suffered a left broken arm. He is done, obviously, for the night. Unfortunately for him, he is a senior. When he walked past me from the training room, absolutely crying, but he said he wanted to be with his teammates out here tonight. Ron?
Oh, boy, that's a toughie. Senior out of Quincy, Florida. So his career is done here at Florida State. Sorry to hear that. Leak right over the middle again. He's got his tight end. And Tate Casey, boy, if they're going to get that kind of coverage, they've got that pass pattern all night long, right?
Yeah, it's a double dig, Ron. What that means is two receivers coming inside. You'll see a short receiver coming underneath and then Tate Casey behind him. So the backers have to jump on the short receiver, opens up Tate Casey.
You know, good description there, Michael. Quick play. This pass is thrown incomplete. Andre Caldwell. And the Gators again trying to speed this thing up a little bit and give Florida State even more to have to not only contend with, but to think about.
You talked about the cupboard. It's almost like having a freezer and getting another freezer because it's so loaded of football talent. This is a young football team. They make some mistakes. The mistakes are mistakes of youth.
10 minutes, 34 seconds showing on the clock until halftime. Florida leads at 7-0. Time of possession very much in their favor, but they have only been able to put it in the end zone one time. And against Florida State, at home, that's not nearly good enough. You see him creeping up on the corner. Will they come on the blitz? Yes. And they're whistled down.
Delay, Ron.
Yeah, I think
that call came from.
Yep, that flag came from deep center field. And Steve Shaw will talk it over with his fellow officials. And here's the delay.
Dead ball. Delay of game on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Let's take another look at this, Ron. See if he got it off in time. Close. That's only good in horseshoes.
So the 5 yards stepped off. It is a second down and 15. Looking back toward the bench to get the play. Here you see Blitz coming, and he's going to try to run out of harm's way and will not be able to. That's Buster Davis with the second sack of the quarterback tonight. And how big is that? They had set up shop with a first and 10 at the 25, and with this sack, they're all the way back to the 43-yard line.
And Buster Davis, who's 5'9", Kevin Steele, the linebacker coach, said he's the best linebacker he ever coached. Sam Mills, who was 5'9". So he said, I don't care about height. If they can run and play like Buster Davis, they can play.
One of the things that Mickey Andrews talked about yesterday as well, speed, speed, and more speed. If you don't have it, you don't play on this defense. Third down, got to take it all the way to the 15-yard line. Leak. Here comes all-out blitz. They get the pass complete. Breaks a tackle. 30, 25, 20. And at the 15-yard line, Andre Coleman. The ball is loose. And Caldwell has it recovered by his teammate, O.J. Small.
You talk about a big-time play by Chris Leak. Hitting Andre Caldwell. The blitz is coming. Florida picked it up. Chris Leak throwing back across his body as he's leaning back to get some extra time, hits Andre Caldwell. And Andre Caldwell shows you he's got a burst.
And guess what? If he had thrown that ball where it should have been, I think he would have been tackled and would not have picked up the first down. As it stands, it's going to be fourth and short. There's a timeout. Let's take it with him. So a timeout now has been taken by Florida State because of the fumble of the ball. He's not going to have the first down, and here's what happened. He gets hit. The ball comes loose right there. And you can see it squirt out, and then his teammate, O.J. Small, on the recovery. And what is he, about a yard and a half short?
Yeah,
yard short. Do you go after it?
I think, first of all, you try to draw Florida State offside. Osei made that hit, Ron, really caused him not to get the first down. I think you have some options here because you got there. Running quarterback Chris Leak, who can run the football, you've got to be able to see if you can get a play and get Florida State to jump here. I would kick the field goal. I'd go up two scores on this Florida State football team. But I know Ron Zook figures that Florida State is a second half football team.
Matt Leach, you were getting a look at him right there. The numbers on him, his longest is 52 yards. He is 10 of 14 on the season, and he stands by ready. Florida State calling the timeout, making sure that they had gone over all of their options under the conditions.
Got to try to draw him off here.
Fourth down, about a yard and a half to pick up the first down. The Leak continues to jump up and down. Facing in motion. Flag is down. Pass is incomplete. It is knocked away. McFadden is the man who got a hand on it. Now let's check the marker.
I don't think that play counts.
Dead ball. False start. Number 84 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Well, under these situations right here, now Ron Zook is saying, thank goodness for freshman mistakes. Because instead of the ball going over to Florida State, they're going to get another opportunity.
Yeah, Tate Casey right here, who's made two great catches, a little anxious.
So it's going to be a 38-yard field goal attempt by Matt Leach. You see his numbers, 10 of 14 on the year. As we mentioned, 52 his longest. He's made five of his last six attempts. Plenty of distance on this one, and he's good. 38-yarder. So with 9:01 left until halftime, our new score, Florida, 10-0. Well, the dedication was done just prior to our kickoff tonight. It is now Bobby Bowden Field at Doak Campbell Stadium. Coach Bowden and his wife, Ann, were down on the field for the special ceremonies prior to the ball game. The announcement was made, and obviously a very popular move as far as the partisan house here in Tallahassee tonight. Petrovich prepares to kick it off for the Gators. Reed and Cromartie, the two deep men. Very high, but this one is returnable. From the seven, it's Reed. And boy, great coverage. He will not even make the 20-yard line on that one. Tonight's Aflac trivia question: who was the last Florida head coach to win in Tallahassee? That answer coming up a little bit later on. You see that sign right here. Very accurate. Spurrier 0-5-1, Zook 0-1, and the question mark as far as the future is concerned, whoever will be the next head coach of the Florida Gators. Lorenzo Booker will check into the ballgame at tailback, number 28. As we mentioned, Leon Washington is the bruiser, and the slasher is Lorenzo Booker. Short drop to throw, no fake on that play, and it aired out. The ball is tipped and tipped again. Closest to it, Ronaldo Hill. And this crowd, with only three Florida State first downs in the first half, getting a little bit anxious.
Well, I was just thinking to myself that if you're Florida right now, Charlie Strong, you're figuring turnover right now. You got an offense that's back on their heels. You got an offense, not much confidence. Now they can't run the football, so you're set up to get a big turnover.
And it was good coverage right there by Ronaldo Hill. In fact, if he had had a little better ball identification, he might have come away with an interception in perfect position. Second and 10, and the quick pass into the middle, and that is to Davis. And Davis is going to have it to about the 19, maybe the 20-yard line, a gain of four. Brandon Seiler on the tackle. Seiler tonight playing for Channing Crowder, and we haven't talked about that, but that's a huge absence in this ball game without him able to go, because Crowder on most everybody's watch list for preseason All-American this year.
A great middle linebacker. And then he's a sophomore. You got Seiler, who's a freshman.
You know, when Seiler came very close to an interception back in the first half, he might have still been running. Third down, they need to take it out to the 26. Sexton, good protection, gets this one, has a man wide open. First down at the 34-yard line for Ponzo Thorpe. Hit by Ronaldo Hill, the senior out of Fort Lauderdale, and the pattern was run perfectly, and the pass was thrown equally as well. Well, there is a flag, and you can see Sexton, he didn't realize there was one. Then he goes running up into the huddle, and Steve Shaw with the call.
Ineligible receiver downfield on the offense, number 14, who was covered up by the wide receiver, 5-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
Another mistake when you have two wide receivers to one side. The other guy covers you up, both on the line of scrimmage.
Mike, explain that a little more for those who, when you say cover up, in other words, they're both on the line of scrimmage.
On the line of scrimmage. And when you have both, when you have so many formations, you run so many different sets, all of a sudden a wide receiver supposed to be a yard back on the line of scrimmage, he gets up on the line of scrimmage and you get X'd out.
You could see at the top of the screen the inside receiver who was on the line talking to the outside receiver. Sexton under pressure, going to be sacked again by Ray McDonald, and that is the second time that they have gotten to Sexton tonight.
Ray McDonald said, I might have jumped offside one time, but I got beat the block of the offensive lineman. On this point, 71, Brian Ross was beaten by McDonald. Field position is going to be very good for Florida.
So Chris Hall to punt it away. Vernell Brown is the deep man, and here's the boot. Not real long, a lazy, wobbly spiral, and he's going to let it hit the ground, and he gets fortunate. It takes a very big bounce back toward the goal line. Only 25 yards on that boot. Let's take a timeout. 10-0 Gators. So it's 10-0. Let me show you the exuberance of the youth of that Florida team. Boy, they are excited. In fact, so excited. Mr. Pulley, the umpire, gets a hug from McDonald as he heads to the far sideline. And he said, hey, guys, I appreciate the affection, but we can't be doing stuff like that right here in front of 80-something thousand people. Boy, good field position for the Florida Gators. And it's a quick pass. This can be a double pass. It was a backwards pass, and the tackle is going to be made. And I'll tell you, they may have a face mask, and it just depends. Is it going to be major, or will it be a five-yard step off? I think McGrew is the man who got a hand on the face mask.
Another smart play by Caldwell not to throw the football.
Incidental face mask.
Incident.
On the defense. Five-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
We're also being told that possibly number 55, Eric Moore, is the man. There you see he goes by, yeah, Eric Moore, number 55. The senior out of Pahokee is the man who got a hand on that face mask. And so it will be a first down and five.
Gavin Dickey at quarterback.
Chris Leak is split out wide to the far side of the field. Shovel pass right up the middle. Breaks off a tackle. And he's going to have it down to around the 30-yard line. Siatric Faison, the junior out of Neptune Beach, got the shovel pass. That thing has got like three options. He can keep it. He can pitch to the trailback or elect to dump it inside, right?
And the draws, Ron, you're exactly right. The draws have really slowed down the rush of FSU.
If I'm not mistaken, I've seen Utah run that same series of plays a lot. They move the chains. It's a first down at the 30-yard line. As Jackson goes in motion and then resets, and now there's movement at the line of scrimmage. And Jonathan Cullen, I believe, the big left tackle, is the guy who will be guilty.
Now, false start, number 78 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Well, the answer to tonight's halftime trivia question: who was the last Florida head coach to win here in Tallahassee? And it was 1986, Galen Hall. And the final score in that ball game was a 4-point margin, 17-13.
Galen Hall with a big day today for Penn State, calling the plays. Big win over Michigan State.
Huge win for that program, the way their season has gone. Faison, they fake it to him. Link steps up, going to go deep. Got position with a man, just overthrows Chad Jackson. Jackson already has a touchdown tonight, and if that ball had been thrown about a yard shorter, he would have had two.
Yeah, good fake by Chris Leak to try to get the ball to Chad Jackson. One-on-one with Brian McFadden. It's corners for Florida State, McFadden, Leroy Smith, who got hurt early in the game, and Cromartie, very good.
Well, you see 29 yards rushing, 177 passing for Florida, 2 yards rushing and 56 passing for Florida State. Second down and 15. They need the 20-yard line. Leak, shovel pass. Faison inside the 35 and down to the 29. And Mike, if we get to look at a replay, I'm not so sure that Faison might not have been the most surprised guy in the stadium. He did not have a head start. Watch it.
Well, sets up, he ran into center.
That's what happened.
Mike DeGore got knocked back into him. That's what surprised him.
Okay. Well, I knew there was a surprise in there somewhere because he didn't have a full head of steam when he caught it.
He blocked him up there. That's what he's saying.
Third down and 9. They still need the 20. About to go under 5 minutes to play in his opening half. Again from a shotgun. Leak all the time in the world. Far sideline. Got a man there. To throw it, and it's intercepted by McFadden. And Leak has got to be kicking himself. He had him wide open for 3 seconds prior to that, and he didn't recognize it in time.
And Ron, you're exactly right. He finally got caught throwing, going away from
yes.
his body,
yeah.
fading back. And then McFadden just was sitting there on the corner route. Here's the all 22. We're going to look at it. Watch the quarterback. Here's McFadden sitting out there. He's just sitting right there waiting on this pass.
Michael.
Should have been thrown sooner.
If he doesn't wait on him, I mean, he's got such a sure touchdown. But as it turned out, the ball comes down and the pickoff is made. And instead of coming away with any points at all, a great job by the Florida State defense to get the ball back. Here to come with a running play. This is Washington, and Leon is going to be roughed up behind the line of scrimmage. That's going to be no gain. In fact, a loss of a couple on the play is defensively Brandon Seiler, the replacement for Channing Crowder tonight, is there to make the stop.
Well, you talk about acceleration by a linebacker. Brandon Seiler just turned on the jets to get to Leon Washington. Florida State cannot run the football.
Florida State rushing tonight, 7 attempts for 0 yards.
I guess that's true. They can't run it.
Here comes a blitz off the corner from the short side of the field. Ball tipped at the line of scrimmage, and it'll go incomplete. You know, the way things are shaping up right now in this first half, ironically, Aaron talked about it was just a week ago that Wyatt Sexton was wearing a Florida jersey. So far in his first half, he's been wearing a Florida jersey also.
He has not made anything happen. Chris Ricks on the sideline has played very well against Florida in the past. We may see him in the second half.
This has been his ball game, hasn't it?
Yes.
It's third down. They need the 30-yard line. Again from the shotgun, Sexton will step up. Pressure was on. Now delivers the ball right over the middle. It is tipped. Goes incomplete. Falls harmlessly away. Willie Reed, the intended receiver.
Ron, here's what you got to think about. Oh, the field position. Here's Chris Ricks against Florida. Career 6 touchdowns and 1 interception. Florida has had great field position. They got to capitalize on it. They got to put more points on the board. 10's good, but they should be hoping to get 17 on the board before half.
5 punts tonight. This is a line drive kick and very returnable, and it'll come from the 39. Vernell Brown. Flags all over the field. Looks like a block in the back.
On the run back, number 15, Vernell Brown.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 22 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First and 10.
Well, coming up at the half, it's the Pontiac High Performance Halftime Report. Wilted Roses, Auburn Rolls, and Peterson shines again. All of that and more on the Pontiac High Performance Halftime Report.
Reese Davis getting ready.
There are the guys getting ready right there. There's Reese.
Get the makeup.
You know what? I tell you what really shocks me. In the last 2 ball games, Wisconsin's going to wind up giving up, what, 79 points? 30 today? Wasn't it 49 last week?
I was impressive today.
Yeah, they were. Faison, no place to go. He's going to be stopped for a couple-yard loss here. Timeouts left. Florida State does have a couple. And don't be surprised if they have a good defensive stop right here if they might not use that first one. Marcelo Church was there defensively. Bobby Bowden paces on the sideline. He has seen difficult situations before in his many years of being a head coach. But this one tonight, not even, just barely over the half century mark as far as total yards in the first half. Here's Leak going to run it. Almost lost the football. He does. And it's recovered by Florida State. The Seminoles get it at the 35-yard line. Chauncey Davis is on the football. Ernie Sims is the man who made the hit. And double jeopardy here as Chris Leak, the starting quarterback, is shaken up on the play.
Chris Leak starts to scramble, drops the ball, never gets it back, and got hit by Sims. And that's the one area you don't want to cause a turnover. If you're Florida, give them the football in the short field with Wyatt Sexton.
Here's where a veteran quarterback, which he will soon be, the minute he fumbled the ball the first time, get on the ground and don't try to do something extraordinary. You've already avoided a train wreck to begin with.
Yeah, it bounced right back in his hands, but he couldn't get it back in against his body when Sims hit him.
Wyatt Sexton comes back onto the field as the quarterback for the Seminoles. They have 56 total yards in this first half and three first downs. But right now they have the ball at the 36-yard line of the Florida Gators. Down 10 to nothing, but an opportunity to get some points back. Florida shows blitz. Here they come. Flags all over the place, and it's been whistled down.
And a single wing play there. Direct snap to Booker.
Dead ball foul. False start. Number 71 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
Talked about one play where Florida had an offside legal procedure, and then it worked out well for them. They kicked a field goal. And here, this play, I think Booker would have been hit and lost about 3 yards.
Well, Brian Ross is the man who was arguing the play. And he obviously is the center who is replacing David Castillo. So the penalty stepped off. It's first down and 15. Sexton looking right over the middle. Got him open. And the tackle made just short of the first down on Chauncey Stovall. It's going to be a gain of about 14 yards. He needed 15. Kyle Jackson makes the tackle on him.
This is a big series for Wyatt Sexton. If they can go in here and score a touchdown and be behind by 3 points, the way they've been dominated in the first half, it will be a win for FSU.
Shotgun formation. Here comes pressure from the open side of the field. Hit as he throws. Far sideline. In zone. It is tipped and knocked away. Incomplete. Pairing with the defensive play.
Ron Zook talked about on our phone conversation this week that Florida State throws more deep footballs, deep passes, than any team he's ever seen. Pro football, college football, wherever.
Well, look at this sputtering Seminoles tonight. Three first downs, 0 for 6 on third down conversions. 71 yards erased by penalties in this first half. Third down and short. Two tight end alignment. And he'll go with the running play straight ahead. And I'll tell you what, I don't think he got it. James Coleman got hit with a head-high tackle, shoulder high, actually. And you can see the Florida players saying, he doesn't have it.
There's got to be something wrong with Leon Washington, the big back. He's 202 pounds. And on a third, critical third, 1 yard to go, you got James Coleman, the fullback, running the football.
I'll tell you what, the two young linebackers, one a sophomore, Earl Everett, number 30, and Brandon Seiler, number 40, a freshman, combining on that stop right there. And now Florida State is going to call a timeout to stop the clock and also to talk it over. They're down 10 to nothing, and they don't want to miss points here. So we are back. College football Saturday primetime, rivalry week, and this one absolutely one of the best this week, presented by Pontiac. 10 to nothing, Florida on top. Decision time. It is fourth down, and they need just about a yard. Lorenzo Booker checks in at tailback. Movement at the line of scrimmage. Was there contact made by Marcus Thomas? Let's see. The officials telling the players to get back. Let's talk it over. I don't know that he made contact.
Offsides, number 44 on the defense. 5-yard penalty will result in a first down.
Marcus Thomas, the sophomore defensive tackle, jumps offside. And alertly, Ross snaps the football to Ricks and caught him in the act.
So that is the fourth first down of the first half. And Mike, two of the four have come by penalty. First down, the new line of scrimmage, the 21. Booker continues to operate a tailback. You see those defenders creeping up. Boy, they got a lot of folks in the box. Pressure up the middle. The pass is caught at the 10-yard line. It'll be first and goal. Stovall again the go-to guy, and Marcus Thomas coming up the middle, number 44, with some heavy pressure. There he is right there. Sexton really got banged down hard by him.
A good throw with the pressure in Wyatt Sexton's face.
Tell you what, he might have been fortunate that he didn't get a personal foul call, because Thomas looked as though he went for his head. He was very high with the double hand shiver, I guess you would call it. Lorenzo Booker remains at tailback. First and goal. Good protection this time. Now he steps up, looks for the pressure, drills it out. Safety valve, and that is the tight end irons, and he takes it inside the five, and the clock will continue to run. They'll say out of bounds at the four.
Missed tackle by Florida's defense. They have a chance against Paul Irons as Wyatt Sexton moves to find the throwing lane.
So they come right back to the line of scrimmage, and now
timeout, Florida. That's their second timeout.
So Florida calls the timeout. They want to talk it over with 32 seconds showing on the clock, and you see the situation. The ball is at the 3-yard line of the Gators. Still, Florida State has not moved on offense more than 100 yards in this opening half. I think what they sit at 88, and only 5 first downs. 2 of those have come by penalty. So it has been, it's been like pulling hen's teeth here trying to get some offense going in the first half.
Our hen's teeth pulled.
Well, that's it, Mike.
They're very
that's the reason for that whole thing.
Very difficult.
Well, game day preparing to go as you look down in the end zone. And the guys got their headsets on and tidied up and ready to go. They'll talk about the wilted roses, Auburn rolls, Peterson shines again, and a lot more else about today's action in college football.
Reese, turn around. Watch this last 32 seconds. Florida State, they like to fade down here. Eric Trav's going to move around now. Look.
You see, they're not going to tell their buddy.
No, they don't they're going to let him alone.
They don't want him to get any FaceTime here, see?
No.
All right, time is back in, and here they come from the 3-yard line. Second down and goal, and Lorenzo Booker again lines up a tailback.
Booker's a good receiver out of the backfield.
From a shotgun, and here they go. Blitz coming right up the middle. Pass is thrown too high. Stovall was there, and it's incomplete. It'll be third down. 27 seconds on the clock.
Pressure again by Brandon Seiler, number 40, not giving Sexton a lot of time. Now this again goes back to the red zone offense by Florida State, having a hard time running the football.
Well, actually, they have done well this year. 31 scores out of 35 possessions. And that scoring percentage leads the ACC at over 88%. Third down, let's see what they come up with from the 3-yard line. Look how many Gators are at the line of scrimmage. Short drop, pass is thrown, and almost intercepted at the 4-yard line. Knocked away by Ronaldo Hill. Rapunzel Thorpe is the guy that they wanted.
And when you talk about an offense that is struggling running the football, you run out of real estate down here to throw the football. You're talking about, you're right, Ronaldo Hill had a chance. Thorpe covered well.
Sismagia to attempt the field goal. It's going to be an attempt of 20 yards. Here is the young man who has replaced Saviad Bathia, who ran into hard times. Bathia has been their regular guy for the last couple of years, and all of a sudden it just went bad for him. And it is now number 12, Garius Ismacia, who is the kicker. He's out of Bradenton and is only a freshman.
And Florida knows they got a young kicker here. They're going to use their timeout.
But you see the numbers. Bathia, 12 of 21, 57%, his longest 48. And Sismacia, perfect. 6 of 6, his longest 48. The fact that high school at Bradenton, he had a 55-yarder. So he's got some leg.
He's got a tough angle right here on the right side. The right hash, about the 3-yard line.
Okay. Bobby Bowden in his career, particularly here at the stadium, has heard enough wide lefts and wide rights. He wants to see a dead center perfect right here to get on the scoreboard. This team struggling on offense, only 88 total yards in the first half, 5 first downs. Here comes the attempt. Ball is down, kick is up, and he is now 7 of 7, and Florida State is on the scoreboard with 17 ticks left on the clock until halftime.
Took advantage of Chris Leak's mistake and put 3 on the board.
In case you just joined us, Leak fumbled on a running play where he decided not to throw. Fumbled the ball, it came right back up in his hands, and he was kind of leaning forward, falling forward, got hit and then fumbled again. And that's when the ball was recovered by the Seminoles, and they come up with, as Mike says, the 20-yard field goal. It's now 10-3.
And both teams at halftime, I'm sure, the pace of this game. Now, FSU's defense now has it down a little bit more than they did at the start. And Florida State's offense got to find a way to run the football. Florida's offense has been very good in the first half, but need more points.
So Bethia gets ready to kick this ball off. McCollum along with Chad Jackson, the two deep men. Cornelius is back there this time. I beg your pardon.
The other thing, Ron, is FSU Bobby Bowden, he's going to talk to his team. They're a good second half football team.
Well, because of all the passing and the incomplete passes, this has been a very long first half, almost 2 hours. Your new score. Here comes the kick. They're going to boot this one on the ground. And it's going to be picked up at the 7-yard line. It's McCollum. And McCollum headed for the sideline. It's going to be bumped out of bounds. 11, now 10 seconds showing on the clock. So, Mike, do you take a chance? Do you?
No.
You don't go on top. You go
no.
to a knee and head to the locker room.
No. They go on the knee and talk about it at halftime. They've squandered away good field position. The interception by Chris Leak, which was big.
See the number 16 of 24, 177, 1-1. As far as touchdown and interception, he'll take a knee. And we're preparing to head to halftime. Clock is down to 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And before we go to halftime, let's check down on the sideline. Aaron Andrews is there with head coach Bobby Bowden. Aaron.
All right, coach, only 88 total yards rushing. Total yards, 0 yards rushing. Why is your offense struggling?
We're not making plays. We're just simply not making plays, and we got to make plays.
Chris
then
Ricks.
You got to credit Florida for it.
Chris Ricks has had 2 great games versus the Gators. Will we see him in the second half?
You're liable to if we don't get something going here for a long.
Coach, thank you.
Okay.
Ron, that's the answer. Back up to you.
Okay, so our halftime score is Florida 10 and Florida State 3. So let's go to commercial break. Game day when we come back with the Pontiac High Performance Halftime Report.
Now the Gators are up by 7. They haven't won it since 1986, and they might have had a bigger lead if not for this play by the Seminole defense. Ryan McFadden picking off Chris Lee.
So our score as we head into the third quarter is Florida 10 and Florida State 3. And Mike Gottfried, when you look at these stats here at halftime, you can get fooled very quickly because Florida dominates the stats. They only need this ball game by 7, and this is a tailor-made situation for a guy like Chris Ricks to come off the bench and be a star, be the hero.
Even Sexton, 2 turnovers in this football game, both by Florida. FSU, no mistakes as far as turnovers and fumbles, interceptions, but they haven't found an answer to run the football. They got to run the football.
And when you look at 5 total first downs for the half, 2 of those came on penalties, which means only 3 offensive first downs in a half. That is not Bobby Bowden, Florida State kind of football. Petrovich to kick it off for the Florida Gators. Willie Reed and Antonio Cromartie, the 2 deep men, and we are underway. very high, and this one is going to be about 2 yards deep. He'll return it. Cromartie will not make it back to the 20-yard line. Outstanding job on special teams. Tonight's first half stats brought to you by Pontiac High Performance. Mike, what do you see?
Big thing right here, the two turnovers, but even bigger for FSU is 0-for-8. And they came into this game 24% on third down, which is very poor, and 0-for-8 in the first half.
Well, Sexton will get the start here in the second half. Warming up down on the sideline, Chris Ricks did throw as the teams came back out, but he will not be the chosen one on this particular series. Sexton steps up, throws out safety valve in the flat, and again he's got Stovall. He has been his favorite go-to guy tonight. Tonight's game track is brought to you by Pioneer. Chris Link, 16-24, 177 yards, a touchdown, but also an interception. And on that interception, boy, he had an opportunity to put even more points on the board, and he underthrew an open receiver, and it cost him. So a couple of mistakes by the young quarterback in the second quarter, very costly.
Young being the key word.
Yep, second down, they need to take it to the 29-yard line. Sexton under pressure, and he's got to be sacked. Earl Everett is the man who gets there to him, and that's the third time that they have come up with the sack.
When we talk about a young football team and Chris Leak being a young quarterback, Wyatt Sexton, Bobby Bowden said next year was supposed to be his year. He's a sophomore. He's been pressed into action, makes a mistake there, takes a sack. But we've seen him play very well against the Cavaliers of Virginia.
Third down, as we mentioned, they need the 29-yard line to keep the drive going. Good protection this time, and he's got it to Stovall. Stovall short of the first down.
Good defensive series by Florida to come out here right away, get three downs and out.
McDonald is the guy who pulled him down, and you can see from the yellow line from where it's been spotted, he's going to be just under a yard short of the first down.
Best play has been the offside of Florida for first down for FSU.
Boy, huge play right there. Good coverage on the special teams, denying them the 20-yard line. And then stopping them a half yard short and time to kick it away. Burnell Brown is the deep man. Here's Hall's boot. Not very long. And now it's going to take a big Florida bounce and head back the other direction. Aaron Andrews, let's check with you on the sideline.
Well, Ron, what may be his last halftime speech as a Gator head coach? Ron Zook told his team, we have two quarters left. We're facing the eighth-ranked team in the nation. No one thinks we can beat them. Let's go out and show everyone we can. Guys?
Well, they had an outstanding plan in the first half, and they led at halftime by 7, 10-3. But as we talked about, situations where being on the road and facing a veteran coaching staff like the one here at Florida State, you better come up with some more points or it could spell disaster. Stats don't mean anything as long as you don't move the scoreboard. From the shotgun, good protection, pass to the far sideline, incomplete. Much better coverage that time as there were a couple of guys out there on Dallas Baker.
Well covered. We talked about Dallas Baker. Trying to see what Florida State does as far as defensively to change from the first half.
Second down and 10. Here comes the option play. Pitches very quickly to Faison. And what a good defensive play by a couple of Seminoles who come up quickly to make the hit. McFadden, the first man, to get out there and turn the play away. And then also quickly there was Pat Watkins.
Watkins is 6'4", 205 pounds, and he can fly. He's the real deal at safety.
So it's third down for Florida. They need to take it out to the 50-yard line to keep their drive going. This time they roll the pocket to the left. Here comes pressure. Just throws this one away as he was hit by Eric Moore, the senior out of Pahokee, Florida. And it's going to be punting time for the Florida Gators now. Two outstanding defensive stands by each team.
And you talked about today the fight in the Clemson game and last night in the NBA. Watch Eric Moore. After he hits Chris Leakey, he helps him up. These guys have played against each other. They have respect for one another's football teams.
This is the fourth time that Florida will have punted. Here's the boot. This is a good one. A line drive. Caught on the run at the 27 is Reed. Flag is down, and he'll be stopped just shy of the 40-yard line. And it looks as though this one is going to take a trip back. 36 on the kick and 9 on the return.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 22 of the receiving team, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first and 10.
So let's take a timeout. 12 minutes remaining, third quarter, and our score remains Florida 10, Florida State 3. So some of the action back in the 70s. Mike Godfrey, can you answer for 20 points? Name of the group?
KC and the Sunshine Boys are from Kansas City, I believe. Oh, God.
Flags are down.
I'll tell you, it's
this has been an inauspicious beginning by both.
Flag day.
By both offenses in the second half.
Dead ball, false start on the offense. The left tackle and left end, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
This rivalry football game, you're pumped up to play it. 365 days, the results of this football game, you got to live with it.
You know, but the interesting thing is you can't play on emotion for 3.5 hours. You got to play with some focus, poise, and smarts. Yep, you do. Near sideline, got it complete to Thorpe. Pushed out of bounds by Ronaldo Hill, but it's good for 20 yards.
When Florida does not pressure wide Sexton and gives him time, this is a deep route by Thorpe, the comeback against Ronaldo Hill. Now, you can't pressure him all the time. You got to play some zone and mix it up.
Sexton has now hit his last three passes. Florida shows blitz. They come off the wide side of the field. Running play, and that's going to be Lorenzo Booker. Let's take a look at the BCS outlook. Now, I talked about this off the top of the telecast tonight. Just perchance, we wind up in a three-way tie in the ACC because there's no playoff game this year. Mike, what the ACC has said, the team with the highest BCA ranking would win a three-way tie. So if Florida State wins tonight, if Miami were to run the table, meaning they would beat Virginia Tech in the last game of the season on the fourth, if they have a higher BCS ranking, it would be the Seminoles who would represent the ACC in the BCS. Dominic Robinson on the catch right there. He was the big man last year, had 5 catches, 102 yards and a touchdown. First time that they have been able to get him the ball tonight.
Going back to your BCS formula, I'm sure them at Miami tonight, Larry Coker saying we beat them head to head.
That's exactly right, but that's what the conference came up with. That was how they detailed it. So head-to-head competition in this situation, unless Miami could win big their remainder of the schedule the way they did today. And they were super impressive against Wake Forest. Pass overthrown. Boy, he had his receiver open, overthrew him in that right flat. Here's what the top 10 has done so far today.
Out, up, back, up, and then Miami won convincingly today.
Well, Wisconsin
against Wake Forest.
How about Wisconsin? They get an opportunity. The door is just left wide open, and they stumbled through it again today. Didn't get through the door. It hit them right in the face.
Screen door.
No, this was a big door, Mike. All of a sudden, this has become a year that they probably would like to forget real soon. David Castillo back in the ballgame at center. Blitz comes. They pick it up. Sexton under heavy pressure, though. He will get back to the line of scrimmage, maybe. And that's about it. Reese Davis, let's check back with you.
Right, Ron, LSU hasn't had a perfect home season since 1972. All they've got to do is beat Ole Miss to finish their home record undefeated, untied, because there are no ties anymore. But Ole Miss has other ideas. Tremaine McBride picking off Jamarcus Russell, and McBride is going the other way. Hotty totty gosh almighty. Rebels are on top, 22-17.
That's amazing. David Cutcliffe has had maybe his best success against LSU, and particularly in Baton Rouge. Rebels on top as the defense scores on the interception return. Florida State third down. The ball is overthrown. They are now 0 of 10 on third down conversions. And Mike, I keep telling you, the stage, you're just building it down here to the far end. The stage is set for Chris Ricks to walk on this field and all of a sudden put on a cape and become Superman. This has been his ball game. It has really been his stage in years past. And the way this game is going offensively for Florida State, it could not get any worse.
Now, when I talked to Ron Zook today, he said, I expect Chris Ricks to play in this football game.
Well, here comes the punt. This is a low driving spiral. Going to be taken in at the 10-yard line by Brown. Flags all over the place as the block in the back occurred. And Florida's going to take over with horrible field position following this penalty. 45 yards on the kick, 5 on a return, but forget the return.
Both teams have been hurt by penalties.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 49 on the receiving team, half the distance to the goal, first and 10.
But the amazing thing is they've been so obvious, you could hear the crowd groan when that block in the back occurred. Let's take a timeout. We'll be right back. So we are back following the penalty. Florida takes it over one of their worst field positions of the night as they'll snap it from their own 4-yard line. And they got their back to the student section right there, and it is very, very loud. And Chris Leak, here's the option play. Pitches it back. Faison, and he's going to have a head of steam out over the 10-yard line. Going to be a gain of about 8 before Jerome Carter finally made the tackle.
When they were backed up in the first half, 97-yard drive by Chris Leak in the offense.
Well, you see where they're going to place that one down, and you see the yellow line. He's about two and a half years short, yards, I should say. Just going to throw this one away. Everybody was covered.
That seems like years when you're calling the plays, though.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a long way. They tried to quick snap the FSU defense. The adjustments made by Mickey Andrews and Kevin Steele, they're prepared a little bit more for this pace in the second half. Started in the second quarter.
Two tight ends of the ball game, Markel Thompson and Tate Casey. See the numbers on Leak. 16-27, 177. Third down, 2.5 for the first. O.J. Small in motion. Pressure off the corner. They throw the screen and the ball is tipped. Little bit of a collision there, but because I think it was behind the line of scrimmage, the reason for no call.
Yeah, main coverage, Pat Watkins right on the coverage, but the pressure on Chris Leak as they come free inside. Eric Moore.
Yeah.
makes Chris Leak backpedal again, throw off his back foot. And Watkins in great coverage, a man coverage.
So it's fourth down. Wilbur with his fifth punt of the night. Willie Reed, the deep man, and they're coming after him. And this is his best kick of the night. High, long, spiral, back to the 30-yard line goes Reed. And he is going to be stopped at the 35. Outstanding coverage by the Gunners that time. And the kick, 56 yards and minus three on the return. Well, tomorrow night at ESPN, it's Sunday Night Football. Brett Favre and the Green Bay Packers face David Carr and the Houston Texans. Packers and Texans also available in high definition on ESPN HD. Coverage begins with NFL Primetime, presented by Miller Lite at 7:30 Eastern.
Ron, Leon Washington into the game.
Chris Ricks continues to pace. Sexton from the 35 gives it to Washington, bounces it outside, has five, has 10, counted off at 11 yards at a first down. And boy, he shows you not only size, but the maneuverability and speed that made a difference on the play.
He's the missing option in this football game tonight. When he's well and he's playing strong and they can run the football.
That is the longest rush of the night. 11 yards, I think they're going to say officially. Longest run of the night. And Florida State all of a sudden over the century mark in total offense in the ballgame. Play action to him. Near sideline ball is caught very high, but he got pushed out of bounds. Chauncey Stovall was hit by Webb. Webb on the play.
Yeah, Ron, you're right. Webb makes a good hit on the sideline on Stovall. Good hit.
And that's the correct call in colleges. If his momentum is taking him in that direction and you hit him in the air and knock him out of bounds, it is no reception, whether he caught it or not. Second down and 10. Clock stops, 8:19 left to play, third quarter. Got him open, same man, Stovall. Gets by a tackler at the 20, and he's down to the 19-yard line. 36 yards in the play. Jarvis Herring finally tripped him up.
Credit the offensive line in Leon Washington for picking up the blitz. They got Webb turned around. Stovall, a big-time receiver. 40 receptions coming into this football game, leading receiver.
Well, you see that David Castillo got shoved out of there. And also, what else happened is Wyatt Sexton got stepped on when Castillo got knocked back.
Dead ball, all sides, on the defense, number 44.
Marcus Thomas.
5-yard penalty. It'll still be first down.
That's twice that Marcus has come across a little quick tonight.
Yeah, Marcus is guessing now. He's trying to anticipate the snap.
Set the clock to 7:42. 7:42.
We talked about
for play.
Florida State, Ron, being a second-half team. Bobby Bowden and his football team, they believe that they can overcome in the second half.
Well, there you see it, 88 in the first, already 87 here in the second half. So it's first down and 5. Florida State trying to tie this one. Down 10-3. Pitch goes back to Washington. Hit behind the line of scrimmage, stayed on his feet, and he may have gotten back to the line of scrimmage. Travis Harris is the guy who got a hand on him.
Corey Bailey also a chance to tackle Leon Washington. This is where Florida's been pretty good inside the 20-yard line on defense tonight.
Dominic Robinson checks into the ball game, number 21. Good size receiver at 6'1", 200. And as we mentioned, last year, he was the hot guy. Had a huge game, 5 catches for over 100 yards. See if they'd look for him. Number 21, Dominic Robinson, out of Diamond Bar, California. They go with a running play, though, when it's Washington. Going to be close to the first down, but still, he's a yard and a half short. Earl Everett pushes him out of bounds.
They're a different team with Leon Washington carrying the football. That will open the passing game for Wyatt Sexton.
Yeah, because prior to this, in this ball game, play action hasn't been a whole heck of a lot.
No.
As you look at third down conversions.
Oh, for April.
Two tight ends, Root and Paul Irons. Need about a yard and a half. You can see the yellow line is just inside the 9. Here comes the pitch. Pressure. They got penetration. He's got to be stopped for a 5-yard loss. And the man who did it, Ray McDonald, he's got 2 sacks tonight and now a tackle for a loss.
It's almost like Florida and Ron Zook knew this play was coming.
Kyle Jackson. Sweep. Kyle Jackson got penetration as well.
I'm sure Charlie Strong's going to tell his defense. I watched Clemson and Tommy Bowden fake a field goal against Miami. So be alert. Seiler is hurt on that play.
Yep, Seiler going to the far sideline. Now let me tell you something. For the fake field goal that Tommy Bowden ran, they're at the proper position on the field, the left hash.
Changed the whole game.
This ball is going to be placed down at the 22. A 32-yard attempt. Szymasia, and oh my goodness, did he yank that one. His first miss of the season. Coach Bowden saying, what is it with wide left here at this stadium with my kickers? Let's take a timeout. 5:28 remaining third quarter. It remains 4-10, Florida State 3. Well, there you have a look at the 80s in this series right here. The music, Loverboy, all the way from Canada. They're not from Kansas City, Mike. Not anymore. That running play, very short yardage. It'll be a gain of 1. Reese Davis, let's check back with you.
Ron, this is how dangerous Utah is. Even the nose tackle scores touchdowns against BYU. Steve Fifita in the backfield. Well, he's by a nose tackle by Trey, but I think he's got to go to running back now. Seconds away from finishing off an 11-0 record.
So Utah rolls 52-21 over BYU. Cornelius in motion from the shotgun. Here comes pressure, and that ball is thrown a little too far in front of Andre Caldwell. It'll stop the clock. 4:50 remaining third quarter.
Chris Lee getting in a bad habit of leaning back when he throws the football. Doesn't get anything velocity on the ball when he's fading back there and stepping back.
Well, his last 6 passes he has missed, except one of them was an interception. If you want to call that a miss as well, you're a Florida fan, you do. From the shotgun, they roll the pocket to the left. Lobs this one, overthrown and almost. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe he wasn't throwing to the short receiver. It is incomplete, but it was closer to the deep receiver. Jamal Cornelius was the closest guy to it.
And that's not good. 3 and out for Florida and Chris Leak. Not sharp here in the second half. Florida State can block a punt. Now, they're very good at special teams.
6th time that they have punted tonight. Wilbur standing, waiting for the snap at the 5-yard line. And here's his boot. Driving wobbly spiral. and Reed all the way back to the 30-yard line. Gets by one tackler. No, he will not. He will be grabbed and knocked down by 22, Reggie Lewis. Going to be a return of 9 following a 49-yard boot. Well, tonight marks the 10th anniversary of the greatest comeback in the series history. Down 31-3, it's Zach Crockett who scored. 3 minutes later, Connell throws to Andre Cooper. The next possession, Connell takes it in, good from 2 yards out, and then Danny Werfel. And the Gators had a chance to seal it, but James Colsey intercepted the pass at the FSU 40, and the offense gets one more try. Watch Rock Preston. He'll tie it up with a 4-yard run. The game that they will always call the choke in the Doak. Straight ahead with the running play. Booker found a big opening, and he'll take it across the 45 to the 47-yard line. Kyle Jackson on the stop.
You talked about Booker being a changeup.
Yeah.
More of a slasher. He has the speed to go the distance. Washington, more of a power guy.
Good look at Leon on the far sideline. Leon Washington out of Jacksonville. He's done a little bit of everything since he has been here at Florida State. Boy, he played special teams his freshman year. He just wanted to play. He made tackles on that team as well. Sweet, nothing doing right here. They're going to wind up with a third down. They lost about a yard on this play. Jeremy Mincy on the tackle.
I think I would throw that play out tonight because Florida so quick.
Don't like that
on
one,
the
huh?
Sweep. No. No.
Falk is running. We're about to hit 3 minutes and 30 seconds left in this third quarter.
Got to run right at Florida.
So Wyatt Sexton comes to the line of scrimmage, which is the 46. They've got to take it to the 50-yard line if they want to hold on to the football. Sets, here comes pressure, runs up into the pocket. He juggled the ball, and then he picks up the first down. 1 of 12 in third down conversions tonight. Their very first one, Corey Bailey finally made the tackle.
And that was a big run by Wyatt Sexton. Nothing open, decides to run for the first down, had the football way out, could have been stripped.
So it's first down, the new line of scrimmage at the Florida 49-yard line. 10-3, Gators on top. Lorenzo Booker remains in the ball game at tailback, and they play action to him. Looking for the near sideline, got one-on-one coverage, and the ball is taken away and intercepted by the Florida Gators, D-Webb.
Charlie Strong with a good defensive call here. Wyatt Sexton throwing into coverage, trying to get the ball to Thorpe. Safety over the top. Webb on coverage. Here comes the safety over the top. Jarvis Herring. Vernell Brown.
If he just throws that ball a half yard further, it's a touchdown. That is an outstanding job of focus by D. Webb. And who is putting on his headgear on the sideline? That's one of the reasons the reaction. Listen to the crowd. From the 20, running play, it'll be very short. Skyler Thornton. And Chris Ricks is starting to warm up.
Great stat in the second half as you watch Chris Ricks. Only 148 yards rushing against Florida State in the second half, all teams. So they shut you down in the run game in the second half.
Second down and 9. Thornton remains in the ball game at tailback. Lee looks for the blitz, throws this one up. It's thrown short and incomplete. Eric Moore, again, number 55, has really done a terrific job of applying pressure on Chris Leak tonight.
Yeah, you're right. Eric Moore, a senior, 6'4", 244. They're coming after Chris Ricks.
Now with the third down and long, wholesale changes by the Florida State defense.
Nickel, dime, they got more. They've got
A lot of
25
change.
25 cents in there. Yeah. In the secondary.
Shiatrick facing the tailback. Third down, they need to take it out to the 30-yard line. Wants to throw the middle screen and then just throws it away.
They have it.
And he is going to throw a flag, and I'll tell you, by rule, what it says, the man has to have a reasonable opportunity to catch that ball, and he didn't because he threw it into the ground. I think that's an accurate call.
34, Ernie Sims played that play as well as you could play it.
There is no flag.
Okay.
Number four was an eligible receiver in the area. It will be fourth down.
Well, I thought that's what he was going to use because it does say he has to have a reasonable opportunity to catch the football. But they talked it over and changed their mind.
Problem for Florida is their offense three and out, not letting their defense get a rest. He wisely threw it at the feet of Faison.
Yes, he did. Willie Reed, the deep man, is Wilbur. Gets his boot away, and this may be his best kick of the night. Very long, all the way back to the 33, fumbles the ball. And Reed makes the recovery.
Chris Ricks is going to come into the game, Ron.
48 yards and a kick, and listen to this ovation that's about to happen. Once they realize that he's on the field, and here he comes. Injury took him out some weeks ago. Then he was unable to get his starting position back from young Wyatt Sexton. Play action. Gets his pass away. Near sideline. Got it complete. Dominic Robinson at the 48-yard line of Florida. Here we go.
Everybody loves a second quarterback. When Chris Ricks was a starter, everybody wanted Wyatt Sexton.
Except, you know, Bobby Bowden said at a meeting yesterday, and he's right on in talking about how progressions happen. He said Wyatt's playing, but he's a year away. He should have been playing next year as a junior, not as a sophomore. Still so much to learn. First down for the 48-yard line. Here was an audible by Chris Ricks. You can see 36, James Coleman, the fullback, coming up to get what the change is. Florida creeps up defensively, wants to throw deep over the middle, got him open. There's Stovall, and Stovall with a first and 10 inside the 30-yard line. Kyle Jackson stops him, but it's a 21-yard gain.
Chris Ricks, two passes, two right on the money. Chauncey Stovall after the fake to Leon Washington. He threw it on time.
Look how close this is. Sider never sees it. It went right over his right shoulder.
It was thrown very well by Chris Ricks.
So again, it's a first down. The new line of scrimmage. The 27 and a half yard line of Florida. Ricks, play action. Sets deep in the pocket. Going to go for the end zone. He's got a man there. Could not get over. That's Crapanzo Thorpe, who he was looking for in the end zone. Ronaldo Hill had the cover, but Chris is saying, hey, let's don't fool around and do this thing. Let's go ahead and score.
Three passes down the field. Bobby Bowden talked about Chris Ricks yesterday. He said has an ankle injury, doesn't run as well.
Yeah.
He said had a chance against Duke, didn't run the football.
He said it was the first time it had really seen where his mobility was limited because of an ankle injury. He's 2 of 3 to open a total of 45 yards. 54 seconds left, third quarter. They'll go with the running play, and that's Washington, and he breaks the tackle, tries to turn it back upfield, and he will take it to the 21-yard line. Reese Davis, let's check with you.
All right, Ron, it is all over at Rice-Eccles Stadium, and the urban myths are now reality. Utah finishes off a perfect season,
beating BYU here, and plenty of Fiesta hats in the celebration as Urban Meyer much rejoicing. That's not official with the Fiesta Bowl. The goalposts are going to need new goalposts. Well, maybe they can pay for some of that BCS money if that's where they wind up.
14 billion reasons why they can if they do receive the BCS at-large bid or one of them. Third down. They need to take it to the 17. Here comes pressure. Ricks is going to run it, and he'll be stopped short of the line of scrimmage. So it's credited as a sack for Ray McDonald. And unofficially, I would say that that's three that they would have by him tonight. That is the end of the third quarter. Let's take a timeout. Our score remains 4-10. Florida State 3 and threatening. Chris Ricks on the sideline getting a break. They're going to go for a field goal. And by the way, they officially said he did get back to the line of scrimmage, so it will be no sack for Ray McDonald. But the tackle at the line of scrimmage, and it brings up a fourth down and about five. And this field goal attempt will be up 39 yards by Gary Sismacia. Good pass, and boy, he is going to miss two in a row. After coming into tonight's ballgame, 6 of 6, both of them are wide left. And our score remains 10-3, the Florida Gators on top.
Hold down, just yanked it to the left.
This one he hit much better. The one that he missed last time, the ball didn't get up very quickly.
No.
So the freshman has missed two in a row, and Florida will get the football back at the 22-yard line. Takes it to Faison, near sideline. Got a man wide open, O.J. Small. Hit and then hit again, finally stopped. But that's going to be a huge gain of 30 yards on the play. Pat Watkins was there to make the defensive stop.
Larry Fedora, the offensive coordinator, said about O.J. Small, he's the crucial guy. We need to get him the ball in crunch time. They did it.
Well, that was a nicely thrown ball right there. As O.J. Small gathered it in, and the senior out of Jacksonville was there to make the play. Look at Faison here with a good second effort. Going to have maybe 5 yards in the play. Jerome Carter comes over to make the tackle. Tonight's game track brought to you by Pioneer. Florida with an early touchdown. They went in front 7-0. And then this pass right here, intercepted by the Florida Gators on a huge play to stop a big Florida State drive. And Chris Ricks back into the lineup. Back to live action, running play. Loose, inside the 30, 25, down to the 20. Siatric Faison with a first down Florida and a run of 23 yards. Ernie Sims saved what could have been a touchdown run.
I believe Ron Zook now has turned this game over to Faison because he knows that Chris Leak is not throwing the ball well. They're going back to the run, and Faison has really run well in two tries.
Skylar Thornton checks into the ballgame, replacing Faison after those two runs, and they give it to him right up the middle. Cracks a tackle, has 5 yards, 7, now 8. They'll place him down at around the 12. Mike DeGore, the junior center out of Palm Bay, Florida, with an outstanding block on the play.
When you know your quarterback's off a little bit in the third quarter, go to the run.
Stack set to the right. They run back into that side of the field. Here's Thornton, and he's going to have the first down inside the 10, down to around the 8-yard line. Roger Williams is over to make the tackle.
Quick snap by Florida. Chris Leak gets right on the ball, snaps the football. They got a bunch set, and all of a sudden Thornton is in the secondary for the first down.
It was Latsko, number 42, the fullback, with a good block on the play. Faison checks back in. You look at number 4 from Sky King. Great view down here in the red zone. Little stutter step, cuts it back into the middle, takes it down to the 5-yard line, maybe the 4. Roger Williams again comes up to make the tackle out of the secondary. And the biggest thing right here for the Florida Gators, all of a sudden, that clock is beginning to fly if you're Florida State. And a touchdown right here would be very, very tough, the way Bobby Bowden's offense has struggled so far this evening. Here comes the pitch back into the boundary, facing, and boy, that's a nice job defensively. Look at all the garnet and gold all over him. A.J. Nicholson, the first man to get out there, along with Ernie Sims, number 34, and the players are still unstacking. I tell you, this has been a physical contest tonight. And we talked back in the first half, at this time of year, everybody's got bumps and bruises, and you just got to make up your mind, I want to play, and I am going to play.
Yeah, well played, good sportsmanship.
Third down from the 4.5-yard line. From the shotgun, Leak pumps once, going to go deep over the middle, and the ball tipped and almost intercepted. Threw it too high as McFadden was almost there to make the pickoff. Dallas Baker, I believe, is the one that he wanted, number 81.
Well defended by Florida State. McFadden has made several plays tonight against Dallas Baker.
He kind of lobbed that one instead of putting a little mustard on it. Field goal attempt coming up. It's got to be placed down at the 11-yard line. Matt Leach with a 38-yarder. This is an attempt of 21 yards. Right hash mark. Ball is down. Kick is on its way. And he's good. Let's take a timeout. 11:51 left in our ball game. And the new score, Florida 13, Florida State 3.
Your chances of survival decreased.
Yesterday at the Florida State Police Headquarters, the American Heart Association awarded three police officers and our own Stevie Carl for helping save the life of Al Taylor, a member of our ESPN primetime crew. You see, Al suffered a heart attack on October the 15th as we were setting up for the Virginia football game here in Tallahassee. And thanks to the quick thinking by all involved, Al is still with us today and well on his way to recovery. Thanks to everybody involved, and it was a nice ceremony yesterday, one that made both parties smile a lot.
A lot of people proud. Thank Al. It's great to have Al back this weekend.
Yep, saw him at the airport, had a big smile on his face. About a month ago, we were not sure that smile was going to be there. Here's a kick 2 yards deep in the end zone. Cromartie fumbles it. He'll go down to a knee. So they will scrimmage from the 20-yard line with 11:51 left to go in the ball game. A Monday night, get all your NFL action on ESPN and ABC. It all begins on ESPN at 7:30 Eastern with Monday Night Countdown presented by UPS. And then at 9, it's ABC's Monday Night Football as Tom Brady and the New England Patriots battle Trent Green and the Kansas City Chiefs. So 7:30, Monday Night Countdown presented by UPS, and then Monday Night Football following that.
Priest Holmes, I believe, will not play in that game.
Boy, he has really turned into a good one in the pros, hasn't he? Play action. Ricks going to go on top. Got one-on-one coverage, wide open. Defensive back fell down, and we may have offensive pass interference on this one. Let's wait for the call as Thorpe made the catch. But there was more than what appeared to be incidental contact on the play. 60 yards if it stands.
Yeah, Vernell Brown's kind of slowed down on Thorpe.
Number one of the offense, half the distance to the goal, repeat first down.
Trefonso Thorpe against Vernell Brown. They just aired out here. Watch Vernell Brown kind of slow down, get in position, got knocked by the left arm of Trefonso Thorpe. Good call.
Yeah, I think the rule says that if the push creates separation, then it is pass interference. And that created separation, I would say.
A lot.
Penalty's going to push it all the way back to the 10-yard line. So it'll be first down and 20 for the Seminoles. Matt Hinshaw, number 14, checks into the lineup. Chris Ricks pass near sideline. Got that one complete to Robinson. And let's check with Aaron Andrews down on the sideline. Aaron.
Ron, Chris Ricks is named Gator Killer by all Florida fans, and with good reason. I had an opportunity to speak to that Gator Killer this afternoon, and he said, of course, he was disappointed he didn't get a chance to start this game, especially because it was senior night. But he said, despite what has happened during his career here at Florida State, he is very, very grateful to this program. I asked Chris why he never transferred from here because of everything that's happened. He said one reason, Bobby Bowden. Guys?
Okay. Yeah, he's there is a mutual admiration respect thing between the two. There's the pass to Hinshaw, and Matt is going to be tackled at the 30, and I believe from where they've marked him down, he's going to have enough for the first down.
Chris Ricks, to add to Aaron Andrews' report, Chris Ricks, Bobby Bowden talked very well about him yesterday in our meeting. Chris Ricks has been a good team guy while being the second team quarterback.
Florida showing blitz off the corner, top of your screen. Let's see if they stay at home or if they bring him. If they're bringing him, and the play goes right by him. 5 yards, still running, close to 10 on the play as Booker ran right by the blitzing player on the outside, and it was a good call if that was an audible, which it appeared to be.
Enough time that you can't just get away from the run. Good block by the fullback, B.J. Dean.
So they've got a down to play with here. Second down, about a yard and a half to pick up the first. On the second and short, they go with the running play, and they give it to the big guy, James Coleman. He will have the first down, and he'll move the chains. Mike, I thought it was funny at the ACC meetings this summer, as the Seminoles have a player down, and it gives me an opportunity to tell a story that Bowden told about his quarterback. And he said, what about Chris Ricks? And he said, you only need to tell him two things: on what day his tests are and where to park. He said, beyond that, he's just fine. One of those big offensive linemen down, it appears to be Ray Willis, the right tackle, the senior out of Falls Mills, Virginia, 6'6", 320. And he is shaken up. I talked about both he and Alex Barron being very, very close. They're both seniors. And in fact, Willis got married during the summer, and Barron was in that wedding because they are such good friends. And Barron, a little bit of a jokester, but they enjoy each other. And I hope that the big fella is not seriously injured. All the offensive linemen have come up very close, though, to check him out.
Yeah, and they can't afford to lose another lineman. And Charlie Strong right now in Florida's defense doesn't want to give up an easy score. They want to make Florida work the field, work that clock, 9:50 to go.
Well, Mike, because they are still attending to the injury with Ray Willis, let's take a timeout. 10-point lead, Florida. Ray Willis had to be helped off the field, and he was giving way on his left leg. Could not tell if it was the left knee or ankle. And you see Overmeyer has checked into the ballgame. David is a freshman out of Lilburn, Georgia, 6'5", 284. Ricks right over the middle, got his man open again. It's Stovall running hard inside the 40. He'll get out of bounds, but they say that he stayed inbounds. Clock will continue to run at the 37, and it was D. Webb defensively after a 19-yard pitch, catch, and run.
Chris Ricks is really on the money here to Chauncey Stovall. He throws on the break. Stovall shows good speed in the secondary.
Clock runs with 9 minutes and 20 seconds left in the ball game. Lorenzo Booker comes in at tailback. Ricks has moved his team well, but they have not come up with any points for him. And that running play right there is going to go for about five and a half yards. Ray McDonald on the stop.
Face mask.
They'll look on the sideline. Now Saviad Bethea is warming up on the sideline. So, you know, it's one of those things where if it's not working for one, then you go to the bullpen and warm up somebody else. Maybe he's had enough time to sit on the sideline to realize what he was doing.
Incidental face mask on the defense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Well, you can see it coming in right there. You see his head being turned. And in fact, they might have been fortunate that a personal foul was not called because he turned his head completely around. McDonald, the man who grabbed the face mask. So with the penalty, first down Florida State. New line of scrimmage, the 27. Channing Crowder in the ballgame. Linebacker, Rick's going to try to run for it. Hot pursuit, still trying to run for it. Gets one pickup block and throws back toward the end zone. And it is caught by Stovall for a touchdown. Mincy with all kind of pressure on the quarterback. And it's going to be the extra point attempt by Sabiad Bathia. And he's got right down Broadway. Let's take a timeout. Florida 13, Florida State 10. Here come the Seminoles. So we are back, and the chant and the chop gets louder here in Tallahassee. Following this kickoff, we're going to show you a replay of the reception in the end zone. And for Florida fans, if you have a weak stomach, you might as well go in and maybe get a cold beverage or something. And for Florida State fans, you'll enjoy it because it is in the books as a touchdown. Here's the kick, 2 yards deep in the end zone, and it's McCollum, far sideline. Whoa, does he get belted down at the 20-yard line. All right, let's take a look. Mike, talk about what happened on the play.
You talked about separation. You see the push-off by Chauncey Stovall against Burnell Brown. Now, both these guys had their hands out there, but the separation occurs when Stovall pushes off on Burnell Brown. Stovall 6'2", Burnell Brown 5'8". Chris Ricks made the play by his athletic feet and moving around.
Well, Stovall has had a great ball game tonight. They have really looked to him every time they needed anything to happen. Under pressure. Lake gets it off. This is to the fullback. Latchko loses the ball, and it is knocked out of bounds. And here is where Florida State, being greedy, instead of trying to recover the football, that is going to remain with Florida. No possession ever changed. Whoa.
Good fake by Chris Lee, getting the ball out in the flat to Latchko. Former walk-on coughed the ball up.
See, he should have recovered instead of trying to pick it up and score the touchdown. And now Florida will have the ball where that fumble occurred, and it's going to be a second down at the 28-yard line.
Many times I've seen Florida this year, nothing comes easy.
Bunch set to the bottom of your screen. Latchko goes in motion, and they give it to the tailback, and Faison puts a head down, running hard, still running hard, and he is going to have 4 more yards after the initial contact was made. Carter finally in the stop, and that run is good for 16.
Yeah, Ron, I want to go back again to what I said. Nothing comes easy for this football team because the youth on this squad. Faison with a great run here. Shows you his strength.
.740 to play in the ball game. Florida by 3. They go with the run again. Faison has 5, has 10, he's off. And only an ankle-high tackle at the 38-yard line prevents what could have been a touchdown, and they'll give him forward progress all the way to the 32. That's a gain of 24 yards. Osei is the man who saved it.
Yeah, Osei. Siatric Faison, one of the players, a lot of the players, being critical of Jeremy Foley, the president of Florida, for the firing of Ron Zook.
Skyler Thornton checks into the ball game at tailback. Number 25 for the Florida Gators. Leak got a man open at the 20-yard line. Completes the pass to Chad Jackson. And you can see where the yellow line is. He is going to have the first down, and they'll move the sticks again. Under 7 minutes left in the ball game. 14 yards on that pass play.
And again, Florida moving the football. I talked about Seattle facing several players came out. Jeremy Foley, the AD, the president of the university, also under criticism by the players of Florida.
Faison, running play right up the middle, gets by one tackler, puts a head down, goes inside the 10, and he may have another first down. And that's Skyler Thornton, I beg your pardon, number 25, rather than Faison on the carry. And a great second effort by the sophomore out of LaGrange, Georgia. And now Faison will come back into the lineup. That's been quite a 1-2 punch for the Florida Gators, and they're going to bring in the change to see if he did, in fact, pick up the first down.
You talked about Faison and Skyler Thornton. Deshaun Wynn, who, another back who's a sophomore. So you got a junior, two sophomores that will return at the tailback position.
That is a first down, and for the Florida Gators, it is first and goal. Clock shows 6 minutes and 23 seconds left in the ball game. A touchdown right here would be devastatingly bad for the Seminoles of Florida State. So they got to think in terms of keeping them out of the end zone, and if nothing else, no more than three. Two tight ends, Florida. Jackson in motion. They'll roll the pocket to that side. Throwback screen near sideline, and the ball was dropped, and that was Lance Butler, the left guard that they were going to throw. And now here comes the flag in.
Lance made a big mistake. First of all, not catching the football, but slamming the ball to the ground is going to pick up a penalty. They had that set up perfect.
You can see Ron Zook say, who's the personal foul on?
I can tell him it's Lance Butler.
Well, for throwing the ball down to be unsportsmanlike, wouldn't be personal foul, would it?
The only thing I saw was him slamming the football down.
There were two fouls. Illegal touching on number 77 on the offense. That penalty is declined. Dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 77 on the offense. That'll be a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. It will be second down. The
boy,
number was 72. Number 72.
If you are a Florida fan, and he knows that he can't touch the football, you got to run away from it. Keep somebody else from making the catch, a defender primarily, but then when he threw the ball down, he was flagged for unsportsmanlike. So that's the reason the ball is being moved back. And they're going to place it down at the 23-yard line. So it is going to be still goal to go, but they're 23 yards away. Cornelius in motion. Flag or pass coming for the end zone, and the ball is tipped. Going to be incomplete, and there's a flag. Baker, the intended receiver, working against Antonio Cromartie.
Pass interference, number 13 on the defense.
15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Instead of a third and goal 23 yards away, they have got a first down again.
Dallas Baker. Cromartie, who's playing Leroy Smith, hurt early in the game.
I think when he grabbed him by the jersey, that's the reason the flag was thrown. So the penalty puts the ball back inside the 10-yard line, and again, it is first and goal, Florida. And now valuable time being eaten up off the clock as far as Florida State is concerned. Shotgun formation, they go with a run. Bounces to the outside, and Faison finally going to be stopped. And I'm not sure that Faison was even lined up right. They had to get him to move to offset just a little bit so he could hand him the football.
May have been a good time for a timeout, because I believe what you said, Faison. Let's go back to that play, Lance Butler. He's covered by a tight end, so he's, I don't know why they threw the ball to him. It's beyond me why Chris Leak threw the football.
Well, the tight end should have stayed back if they were going to throw back to him.
To the tight end, but he went downfield.
Second and goal. Leak sets in the pocket over the middle, and this is overthrown. And again, toss that one off his back foot, just trying to throw it away. But you're right, Mike, that is a really bad habit to get into, isn't it?
Yeah, late in the season, he's backing up, not throwing with his body moving forward, stepping to the receiver. He's stepping away from the receiver.
Travis Johnson comes out of the ball game. They'll lose the big defensive tackle for one play. His headgear, something was malfunctioning, had to come over to the equipment man. And you see he's still taking it off and trying it on. Ninth play, this all started back at the 20-yard line. It is third down and goal. Leak from a shotgun, goes with a running play, face it up the middle, he will score! Jonathan Cullen, number 78, with a paving block on the play. That's 59 seconds showing on the clock. Leach with the extra point attempt gets a low pass, and the kick is up, and he's good. And that, let's take one more look at it as we head to commercial. And the Florida Gators all of a sudden with a 10-point lead. You saw the block by 78. Jonathan Cullen paving the way, and Faison races it into the end zone. 10-point Florida lead. 20-10, our new score. Florida now increasing their lead back to 10 points. Faison, 8 carries, 18 yards first half, 11 carries, 84 yards here in the second half. Coming up next, SportsCenter, Scott Van Pelt and Steve Levy. Basketball and what's next? Rivalry Saturday, South Carolina and Clemson in their brouhaha. And also, Spurrier speaks. That and more coming up on SportsCenter immediately following our ball game. Right now, we're at the 4:59 mark. Is the sign correct? The streak ends here in 2004. Well, we still got just under 5 minutes to find out. Petrovic prepares to kick it off. If you're Florida, you cannot begin to celebrate too quickly. If you're Florida State, you got to have total focus. You got plenty of time to score 10 points, and you don't return it 5 yards deep in the end zone. And he is going to be grabbed by the face mask and now reverses his field. Here comes another flag in. Breaks it up the sideline, 50, 45, and finally is out of bounds at the 39-yard line. So we may have a face mask and a hold. 61 yards on the return. I think it was Baker who grabbed him with the face mask for Florida.
Personal foul, face mask, number 81 on the kicking team.
Yep.
15 Baker. Yards from the end of the run. First down.
So there was a second flag I thought I saw, but obviously there was not another penalty. So a 61-yard return, and just like that, Florida State.
Right back in great field position. There's the face mask, Dallas Baker. Chris Ricks on the last series made a great play with his feet to buy time. And threw the long pass for the touchdown.
.445 left in the ball game. Florida State right back in there. Ricks under pressure, going to be sacked at the 35 by Marcus Thomas.
Here's the last drive, Ron, when Chris Ricks really made this play happen. Scrambled, bought time, tried to run, now stops, gets set back up, and heaves the ball downfield for Stovall for the touchdown.
Ricks with the second down. Here comes pressure again. Zings this one, and the ball incomplete, in and out of the hands of the receiver. I think we have unofficially 5 dropped passes by Florida State tonight.
Early in the game, we had a bunch,
yeah.
3. That would have set up Wyatt Sexton for a better outing. First downs were missed. Ball, they had great field position on the first drive. A couple drops.
Third down. They're going to take it all the way down to the 14-yard line. Here comes a blitz off the corner. Top of the screen. Pressure there. Stops. Delivers toward the end zone. Got a man down there. And it is knocked away at the last moment on a terrific defensive play by D. Webb. Demetrius Webb, the sophomore out of Jacksonville, ran a long way to get to the football.
And Ricks almost had another one. But D. Webb really sprints to knock the ball away from Dominic Robinson.
So who are they going to go with? Looks as though Sabiyad Bathia will attempt this field goal. They're going to place this down at the 42-yard line. So it's a 52-yard attempt. His longest, 48, as you can see. Good pass. Ball is down. Does he have enough leg? Yes, he does, and he's good. That is a new career long. His longest was in the Gator Bowl 2002 with a 50-yard boot. Now that one, 52, and the mistake by Baker cost him that quickly. They burned what? Almost a minute off, and that's it.
Field position, now you're 1 score away. Onside kick or kick the ball deep. You got 3 timeouts either way now.
Do you onside kick, Mike, or do you that pooch job?
I think you do onside kick, but you got enough time if you choose to kick the ball deep for your defense to stop Florida. But the way Faison is running, I don't know that you don't. Now might be the time for the onside kick.
Well, your point is well taken, because Faison in the second half, that number we showed you, 84 yards and a touchdown, he really has been a difference maker in the second half of play. Well, here are the BCS standings brought to you by Allstate. And here they are right here. SC Oklahoma, Auburn. Also, Cal won today. Texas Idol, a win by Utah, lost by Michigan. Florida State, jury's still out on this one, and a win by Boise and also by Louisville.
Cal with a big win. Auburn with a big win over their arch rival.
Mayhew prepares to kick it off. Let's see if he kicks it away, if he squibs it, or if he's not lined up to onside it. He kicks it short and high. This is a spinner. And it's going to be taken at the 6-yard line by McCollum. And McCollum is not going to make the 20-yard line. He'll be stopped at the 17.
When you got the best defense and you figure you can stop Florida, now you got three timeouts left, 3:43 on the clock. Bobby Bowden rolling the dice to stop facing.
Mike, do you also gamble? Do you put about 8, 9 in the box and say, you know, we're gonna take that chance, particularly here on first down? Or do you play it? Looks like they're playing it straight away. Linebackers at normal depth, but here comes a safety on the blitz, and they also send a linebacker. Late under heavy pressure, and that ball is thrown away after his arm is hit.
And that saves a timeout for FSU. Chris Leak on the rollout, trying to get the ball to Andre Caldwell.
Well, that's Eric Moore, who has been demon as far as being a pass rusher tonight. Look at Ron Zook. He's saying, how can 3 minutes and 36 seconds take so long? But it's going to take a lot more.
Yeah, he's done a great job, Ron, to get fired the week of the Georgia game. And everybody always asks, why did they fire him the week of the Georgia game? I think the reason is they didn't want him to win 4 straight games. Then you have a harder time firing a coach. But you can't evaluate a coach in 2.5 years. And he's got a young football team here. The football team loves him. His recruiting's going well this year. And all of a sudden, the week of the Georgia game, the plug's pulled.
Strange timing. There's no question about that, as Moore is being helped up by the training staff. Actually, they're still looking at that left ankle. Sports Center coming up next, immediately following our ball game, and that is 3 minutes and 36 seconds from now. And you see Eric is up hobbling, but is coming off the field under his own power, which is always good to see.
I think you'll see a run here with Faison. I would figure trying to force Florida State to call a timeout.
Leak under center this time. Takes the snap, gives it to Faison right up the middle, has 5, has 8 and 9. He's going to be very close to the first down. You can see where the yellow line is, and it depends on where they're going to spot him down. They'll give him a spot just across the 25, around the 26. He's still got about 1.5 yards to pick it up.
You talked about gambling. Now's the time for Mickey Andrews to gamble. You're going to bring them all up. Blitz trying to stop Faison.
O.J. Small comes into the ball game at wide receiver, bringing the play. He is at the bottom of the screen, joining another wide receiver who appears to be Chad Jackson. And they give it to Faison right up the middle, hurdles a man, and I believe he has the first down. From where that line judge is coming in, you see his left foot. Well, I don't know. From where the left foot was finally placed down, I'll tell you what, he may miss this just by inches.
Let's see what the yellow line. No, didn't make it.
Nope. Now let's see with the spot, and here comes the chain in from across the way. Yeah, but he's going to miss it just as we suggested, by inches.
And you got to punt the football. Eric Wilbur, who's been a very good weapon for this Gator football team. Got to get the first down here first. Florida State now taking the timeout. Third down.
So 2:38 showing on the clock. The last time the Gators won in Tallahassee was back in 1986. Octavius Gould ran it in from 5 yards out to put Florida up by 7, but the Noles took the lead at the half. And the game remembered as the rain poured down in the second half. Kerwin Bell to Ricky DeTeal in the touchdown pass. Gators went up 17-13. And then Bowden-Stolz turned the ball over on downs. Galen Hall became the last Florida coach to win at Doak Campbell Stadium, which is now Bobby Bowden Field at Doak Campbell Stadium.
Fourth down. You have to punt the football. Wilbur, you know Florida State's going to come after the ball. They're going to come after the punt. They're bringing the offense back on.
You see Coach Bowden talking over the headsets, and he relayed that same message. He's asking upstairs, he said, are they bringing the offense out, or do they have the kick team on there? This is the regular offense.
Got to be a shift here. That's the only thing I can figure.
Leak is going to go under center. Quarterback sneak takes it straight ahead, and he will have it. Whoa, what a gutsy call by Ron Zook.
Well, they can't fire him again. So you make the call and you try to get the first down. It's close. All depends on the spot. Florida thinks they made it.
You're right. And you see that official making sure nobody touches or moves the football. Here they stretch it out. And it is first and 10.
When your job security is the 3 minutes to go, you can make that call. And Ron Zook, gutsy call. And you got to feel that he's thinking, hey, if I could just have had this football team for another year, a lot could have happened.
Payson, nothing at left guard, tries to bounce it outside, and you see him going down, making sure that he continues to run the clock. Smart move on his part. He knew he was going to be tackled, but you see him just drop his legs out from under himself to make sure the clock would continue to run. Timeout called to stop the clock. Florida State, they have one remaining. They'll stop it at 2:05, and it's only because of the play of Siatric Faison when he did go down.
I agree, and the quarterback sneak. And you think about Ron Zook and his coaching staff, what they've gone through in the last 4 weeks, and the coaches have said, we tried to focus, we tried to worry about these 4 weeks. That's all we can control. Larry Fedora told us the other day on the phone that he said his kids, when they got fired, he went home to tell his kids and his wife that they had gotten fired. His kids were upset. They were crying. Didn't want to go to school the next day. They were embarrassed because they got fired. Larry Fedora and Ron Zook all told their kids, hey, we did a good job, and we should still be here. We have nothing to be embarrassed about.
Let me show you something here, Mike. This is a class of coaches. The record is through their third season. We include Jeff Tedford, who has done such an outstanding job at Cal, Ty Willingham at Notre Dame, and you see Ron Zook there in his period of time with 22 wins, Tedford with 24, Tyrone Willingham with 18.
There's Larry Fedora. They ought to rehire him after the game.
Florida hustling back out on the field. Play clock shows 10. They got plenty of time. Faison runs into his own man. Going to be hit behind the line of scrimmage. That's Wembley, who will make the tackle. And it appears that Florida State, and that's their final timeout.
Ron, going back to the coaches, I was fired, so I know how the feeling is. You know you can't do anything about it. It's over, and you got to look ahead. Ron Zook will get a head job. And his staff and his families all got to move again. But that's a part of the business when you're not wanted.
Ron Franklin, Mike Godfrey, Aaron Andrews coming to you from a jam-packed Bobby Bowden Field at Doak Campbell Stadium in Tallahassee, Florida. The night started off with the Florida Gators Trying first blood, they scored a touchdown, went up 7-0, then 10-0. Then all of a sudden, the Seminoles started to come back, and it appeared as though that they were going to be able to light a fire under an offense that had just been slumbering all night long. But in the second half, if there was a difference maker, Seatric Faison came into the ball game. The running game became a huge part of the Gators' offense. And also, Chris Leak settled down where he had had a rough late second quarter. And in the third quarter, all of a sudden, it started to work for them again. And right now, they are 1 minute and 58 seconds away from pulling a huge upset and knocking Florida State out of a possible BCS bid.
You're right. This game means a lot to FSU.
There's Faison right there. 18 first half yards. Right now he's got 106 on 23 carries. He doesn't care about yardage right now, though. He just wants to hold on to the football and make that clock run, and quickly.
Florida wants to talk this play over.
I'm out. Florida. That's their first time out.
So let's step aside. 1:58 left in our ball game. Florida 20-13. Don't want any hanging Chad now. So we are back, and the emotions really beginning to be sky high now as the Florida Gator fans realize that they're just under 2 minutes away from pulling off a gigantic win here in Tallahassee. And for the Florida State faithful, they're looking for another miracle. It's happened before. Can they make it happen now? Running play, they gamble, and Faison hit behind the line of scrimmage. Going to lose yardage on the play. Charles Howard is the guy who got penetration, number 59, the big senior out of Lake Butler, Florida.
You know this. The punt block is coming here. The rush of Florida State to try to get Eric Wilbur, who's been great tonight, kicking the football. Florida gonna run this clock down.
Well, let's see, they have got 7 seconds on the play clock. Down to three, down to two. High pass, and they get the kick away in a good driving spiral. All the way back to the 29-yard line. 35. At the 40, and Florida State will take it over with great field position. 51 yards in the kick and 16 on the return, and Reed has got them in a great spot. They got to have a touchdown, but they're only 55 yards away, and they got 63 seconds showing on the scoreboard.
And Chris Rex is a guy that's been hot tonight. 6 out of 9.
Nobody has left this stadium. I mean, everybody, whether they're wearing the colors of Florida or Florida State. We've got 63 seconds left. It is 20-13. Ricks from the shotgun. Quick pass tipped at the line of scrimmage. It'll go incomplete, and it will be second down. Tipped by Seiler. You know, Brandon Seiler, for a freshman,
been great.
Has come in and has really done an outstanding job.
Really has. Channing Crowder, you talked about it. He's absent tonight. A great linebacker. Seiler has stepped in here and hasn't missed a beat.
59 on the clock. Ricks throws this one. Got Thorpe open at the 32-yard line. It'll be first down, Florida State. 24 yards in the pass play, and Kyle Jackson finally made the tackle.
Nothing comes easy for the sport of football, team. Youth shows up.
That only took 6 seconds. 53 on the clock. They're about to whistle it back in. The umpire will cover the football until Steve Shaw says, "We are set." And they do. 50 seconds down to 49. Here comes pressure right up the middle. They throw the screen. Got it complete. Booker gets by one tackler trying to get out of bounds, and he will at the 26-yard line. Ronaldo Hill is the man who made the tackle, but it's good for 4 yards.
Smart play by Lorenzo Booker. He knew he had to get to that sideline. even though he only picks up 4 yards, they stopped the clock.
Because Florida State with no timeouts remaining. So it is second down. The line to make is the 21 of Florida to pick up the first down. And Ricks knows he cannot be sacked with no timeouts left. That would eat up a majority of the time left on that clock. From the shotgun, here it comes. Near sideline, which is the open side of the field. It's stuck, and he falls down intentionally. It does not go out of bounds.
Couldn't get out of bounds, Ron. He fell down. First down, stops the clock.
It is stopped right now at 32 seconds. And as soon as they uncover it, the clock will start running again. It'll go from the ready. And there it is there. 31 seconds, down to 30, and he'll down the football on first down and stop the clock at 28.
A lot of time there, 4 seconds, down the clock, down the football and stop the clock. Bobby Bowden talked to you about Chris Ricks, said he will play Ron Zook. I talked to him, he said, I know I'm gonna see Chris Ricks.
And what he wants to see right now is not only to see Chris Ricks.
Zeros.
He wants to see him celebrating. They are 18 yards away with 20 seconds showing on the clock. Pressure coming up the middle. Ricks scrambles to the sideline. Now stops, throws for the end zone, and simply throws it away. 20 seconds showing on the clock.
Chris Ricks again sprinting to the right. Wisely throws the ball away. Cedric Payson cannot watch this football game.
Well, there are several players on the Florida sideline that are either looking at the ground or put towels over their head. They simply didn't want to see what happened. They want to gauge from the crowd. 20 seconds left in the ball game. Florida on top, 20-13. Here's third down. Ricks deep in the pocket, throws for the end zone. Thorpe is there, and he turns himself around and couldn't get back to the football. He was there, but he turned the wrong direction, and now we have 14 seconds left, and it will be fourth down.
Florida State wanted a call there. Profonso Thorpe just couldn't pick up the football.
Crowd is wanting desperately to think that there was pass interference. There was none. It was Thorpe who got himself so turned around. And Crowder, by the way, had come into ball game to help cover on that play, number 55. Fourth down. Here is your ball game right here, unless they can pick up the first.
There's Thorpe.
Ricks sets deep in the pocket. Pressure. Ball is intercepted by Florida at the 10-yard line. Intercepted by Jarvis Herring. And again, how many times have we said tonight, Marcus Thomas with pressure coming up the middle, and he did it again. Ron Zook in his final ball game at Gainesville, or as far as the head coach at Gainesville, is going to go away with a victory here in Tallahassee. We have 8 seconds showing on the clock, and Bobby Bowden knows what has just gone by the boards, an opportunity to represent the ACC as a BCS team. And man, all of a sudden, the Florida Gators, and they're starting to ride for Ron Zook right now, and we still got 8 seconds showing on the clock. He'll take a knee, and that will do it. The Florida Gators with that improbable, huge upset here in Tallahassee, Florida. Let's go through what happened in that final sequence, Mike.
Herring with a big interception on Chris Ricks. Under pressure, you talked about Thomas. Ron Zook, no better feeling for him. Last game to win here at FSU.
Still trying, that mass of humanity, trying to find Coach Bowden. Good look at Wyatt Sexton as he will head to the locker room, obviously disappointed. His ball club, featured our favorite in the ball game. Let's go down to the sideline, and here is Aaron Andrews.
With Coach Ron Zook with the game ball. It has taken 18 years for the Gators to snap the losing streak here. What does it feel like to walk off this field a winner?
I'm so happy for our players, our coaches, and our fans. I mean, I'm happy for them. You know, these guys have done a great job. They've done everything we've asked them to do. Coaches have coached their butt off, and they played it often. I'm so proud of them and so happy for them. I really am.
Coach, what was going through your mind that last play?
I was just trying to watch the routes and what was going on. A lot of things going through my mind.
Have to ask you, of course, everybody wanting to know, is this it for you? Will you coach the Gators in a bowl game?
I don't know. I haven't thought about any of that stuff. And right now, I want to go in and celebrate with our players and our coaches and our families. And I'm so happy and proud of them guys. They've gone through a lot this year. And they kept doing it. Our coaches did an unbelievable job of doing what we had to do and working. Like I said, the football team is getting close, and they are. We started to get better, and we just continue to get better, and they hung in there, and they believed in us, and they believed in themselves, and this team is going to win a lot of games here. I'm so happy and so proud of them.
Congratulations, and thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Ron, back to you.
So the final score, Florida 20 and Florida State 13. And coming up next, it's SportsCenter. And over on ESPN News, it's Postgame Extra. For more, log on to ESPN.com, your home for college football. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Good night, everybody, from Tallahassee, Florida.